Welcome everyone for the Epignosis National Level Surgery Long Case Presentation Competition. We are done with the short case presentation, which will be useful for the examination of all undergraduate students. Now, in big way coming up, the most important aspect of any examination is long case presentation. Our passing and failing depends on this one particular case presentation, that is long case presentation. So it's very difficult for any student, any brilliant, intelligent student, to directly go to the examination hall and present a case to a examiner. In that regard, our mentors of White Army and also patrons, Professor Guru sir and Professor Srinivasan sir, gave us advice or suggestion to do a mock examination kind, to in order to give you a good practice as well as to boost your morale and confidence levels. And you also will come to know what the examiner expects from you, what kind of questions they will ask you, and how you should be prepared, and how you should be answering, how to convince them. Everything you will learn only by practice. To practice that, you need some big stages like this, wherein you can present to some external examiners who are seasoned examiners, senior most professors, and also have vast knowledge and experience. In that regard, as per our mentor's suggestions, we have organized this event today. And we got a very good response, Guru sir. When we posted about the event, we received more than 170 applications. Case presentations, we selected 21 cases for the long cases and 28 cases for the short cases. And the finalists are here with us today. On behalf of all the members, I really applaud those who got selected for the finals and for your perseverance and hard efforts. And mentor, as a mentor today, we have Professor Srinivasan sir, who's a grand mentor and also patron of White Army, who has been constantly supporting us, guiding us, blessing us. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. He's
from Coimbatore Medical College. And as a judge and also mentor today, we have our own Professor Gurushanta Pelagachin sir, who is a HOD at prestigious KIMS Hubli, and also more than that, he's a very passionate teacher and a national faculty of surgery. He has taken many classes for the student in White Army. There are so many videos available in our channel by him. So he has agreed to be the judge today. It's a great privilege and blessing for us. Thank you so much, sir, for being
Thank
with
you.
Us today.
Thank you.
Yeah. So as per mentor suggestions, among 20 students, we'll have first 10 in this part one and other 10 in the next session. So I request Mr. Kunj Dabuwala from LTMC and Sion Hospital, Mumbai, to start the presentation.
Yes, sir.
All the best, Kunj.
Thank you, sir. Sir, is this
visible? Yeah, visible. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Today, I will be presenting a case of 78-year-old female homemaker who is resident of Dharavi, hailing from Ratnagiri, who presented with chief complaints of swelling in front of the neck since 3 months. The patient was apparently all right 3 months back when she noticed a swelling in the neck while dressing and was also noticed by relatives. It was initially only in the center of the neck, of size approximately 2 into 2 centimeters, which then progressed to the current size of 6 into 4 centimeters, extending up to the right side of the neck in the course of the 3 months. However, there is no history suggestive of hypo or hyperfunctioning of the thyroid gland, no hoarseness or stridor or difficulty in the swallowing. The patient does not complain of any exposure to radiations, no joint pain or rash, and there are no similar complaints in the family members or in the neighborhood. There is no pain or discharge associated with the swelling. Also, there is no history of any ulcer in the mouth, neither any fever or cough with expectoration, nor there are any similar swellings in the axilla or groin. She is a known case of diabetes mellitus and hypertension since 15 years and is on oral medications for the same, and it is adequately under control. The past history, there is no recent hospitalization, no history of bronchiolasthoma, tuberculosis, epilepsy, or other chronic diseases. The personal history, the sleep is unaltered. The patient consumes a predominantly vegetarian diet. The appetite is normal. The bladder and bowel movements are unaltered, and she denies any addictions. the menstrual history, she achieved a menarche at 13 years of age. Since then, she had regular cycles of about 30 days with a plus minus of 2 days. And at the age of 50 years, she achieved her menopause. There are no similar complaints in the family. Coming to the summary as per the history, this is a 78-year-old postmenopausal lady who is diabetic and hypertensive and has presented with a midline neck swelling since 3 months, which has rapidly increased in size, and she is clinically euthyroid. Coming to physical examination, I examine the patient in adequate light with good exposure and with consent in presence of...
Yeah, Kunj, 1 second. Kishan, what is the procedure you have kept?
We can do this, sir. History and examination, like usual, we can do, sir.
Seven minutes for presentation, sir. And questionnaire for 8 minutes.
Let him finish off whole of the presentation or...
Okay, sir. Okay. That's better.
And then go to the examination.
No, we'll... whole presentation, sir, first.
Whole. Okay, continue.
Coming to the physical examination, I examine the patient in adequate light with good exposure and with consent in presence of female attendant. She is conscious, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. She averagely built and well-nourished with a BMI of 22, and she is sitting comfortably on the bed. The vitals, she is currently afebrile with a pulse rate of 100 beats per minute measured in the right radial artery in sitting position, which is regular in rhythm, normal in character, force, volume, and tension, and it is bilaterally symmetrical. The blood pressure is 110 by 70 millimeters of mercury measured in the right brachial artery. The respiratory rate is 15 cycles per minute. Pallor is present. There is no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, or edema. The eyes are normal. The skull, skin, spine are normal. And there are no features of hyper or hypothyroidism seen. On local examination, I performed it. The patient was in sitting position. On inspection with the neck extended, there's a single neck swelling in the midline extending from the center to the right side, which is limited laterally by the sternocleidomastoid muscle and superiorly by the thyroid cartilage, and inferiorly the swelling is above suprachenal notch. The dimensions are about 6 centimeters in the horizontal dimension and 5 centimeters vertically, with a smooth surface, and the overlying skin is normal. There are no scars, sinuses, or dilated veins. The swelling moves up with deglutination, but not on tongue protrusion. A palpation was performed with neck flexed and standing behind the patient. A single neck swelling could be palpated from the extending from the center of the neck to the right side, limited laterally by the sternocleidomastoid muscle, superiorly below the notch of the thyroid cartilage, and inferiorly it is 1 centimeter above the suprachenal notch. The swelling is 7 centimeters in length, 5 centimeters in the horizontal length, the 5 centimeters vertically in the midline, and 6 centimeters vertically on the right side, and 2 centimeters in depth. The swelling has a smooth surface, it is firm in consistency, and all margins are palpable. The skin over the swelling can be pinched. The swelling is also mobile along and perpendicular to the fibers of the right sternocleidomastoid muscle. Both the carotid pulses are palpable. No neck nodes could be palpated, and the trachea is central in position. On Lahir's test, the lateral borders are palpable and are rounded. On Cocker's test, no stridor is heard. A percussion is not contributory and auscultation is not contributory. On other system examination, a respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds are heard. Cardiovascular system examination, S1 and S2 are heard with no murmurs. Per abdomen is soft, non-tender and bowel sounds are heard. And on central nervous system examination, no neurological deficits could be are present. For the clinical diagnosis, this is a case of solitary nodular goiter, which is clinically euthyroid and probably is malignant. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Kunj, by chance, you have any clinical photographs of this patient?
So I have, but not on the mobile. I haven't transferred it in the PPT.
Okay, you have not put in the slides?
No, sir.
Okay. Can you come back to the history slide?
Yes, sir.
So she is basically with a midline neck swelling.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What is that you thought at history level before you start examining the patient?
So at the end of history, it could be a central neck swelling, which could be a thyroid gland or a lymph node or any congenital cyst which could be present.
Which is more likely in this case, whatever you have examined the case later, at history level, you thought of what among this?
So at the, In this patient, I thought of a thyroid gland. So,
which is the commonest neck swelling?
So lymph node, sir.
Lymph node swelling. If lymph that is the case, where what will be the history?
So in case of lymphadenopathy, sir.
If you say commonest swelling is what swelling in the neck?
So it could be like on history there would be features like most commonly the lymphadenopathy is could be because of tuberculosis in infective cause. So you know on history I would like to elicit about the symptoms of tuberculosis like fever, cough, and night sweats, all those things.
Okay, you have mentioned in the history that there is no history of discharge, even though clinically at history level you felt that it is a thyroid swelling. Was there any idea of asking that history of discharge from the swelling?
So as a general symptom for swelling, I wanted to ask for any discharge to rule out any other.
Anyway, whenever you present a case and she says it is a midline or a center part of the neck swelling at history level, there is no need to highlight that there is a history of discharge unless it is there. If it is there, you highlight. If it is not there, don't bring that for discussion. Okay. If she has presented with a lateral neck swelling in the neck, lateral neck swelling, definitely it has got a meaning in highlighting whether it is present or not.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Fine. So at history level, you felt it is a thyroid swelling. That is why you asked history suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How often, if the patient had the symptoms suggestive of hyperthyroidism?
Yes, sir.
At history level, and after having examined the patient completely, what would have been your diagnosis?
In that case, that would be a toxic solitary nodule, which
Toxic goiter. Can you come back to the inspection slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You have mentioned here, after a description, I would have appreciated if you have put a clinical photograph. To all the students, whenever you present a case in the system that is online, it is better you should have clinical photographs, 2-3 clinical photographs. And if it is a case like this, where you're concluding as a thyroid, if you can put a short video of few seconds movement to the deglutition, definitely it will fetch you more marks.
Okay.
And it will give a lot of information to the teacher and to the listeners. Okay. So a single photograph will explain many things. And you can find out whether some findings you have missed looking at the photographs. We may find out maybe what is not seen to you may be seen to someone else. So if you can put the photographs, okay?
Yes, sir. So can I present a different slide?
We will not allow now. You already, because you knew that you are going to present this. Okay. Sir Srinivasan, sir, is it right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, sir. Yeah. We can stick to the timing, sir. 8 minutes.
Exactly. Exactly. Sir, somebody is supervising the timings?
I told Kishan, sir. To...
Okay, sir. Yeah. In the palpation, how did you do inspection?
I was standing in front of the patient and the patient was in sitting position. And I asked the patient to extend the neck. So swelling got prominent and I inspected the swelling in that manner.
What, you were the position in front of standing or you were also sitting in front of the patient?
Sir, patient was sitting on the bed.
No, patient was sitting. What about you?
I was at the swelling was at my eye level. So I was sitting on a stool.
So you were also sitting. That's what I wanted to know from you as an undergraduate. Was it at our eye level? That's all.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So inspection has to be described in front of the patient so that you can find out all the details. Okay. So how did you do palpation?
For palpation, I went behind the patient. The patient was sitting on the stool and I asked the patient to flex the neck and then I palpated with both my hands, fingers.
What is that Lahis method you have described?
Lahis method, I was in the front of the patient and I with my right hand, I pushed the swelling towards the right from the left side of the swelling and with the left hand, I palpated the swelling.
What is the idea of doing this test?
So for assessing the any borders of the lateral borders of the thyroid gland and for seeing if there is any nodules which could be on the lateral side of the
It is not like that. This method is basically to know the details of a nodule which you have already palpated. Like examination of a peripheral swelling, if it is on the surface, like in the hand, to know the details like that, because it is deep seated, supported, because the laryngeal complex is a mobile structure. If you do it only with the in hand, you may miss many findings. So support with the opposite hand on the opposite side and try to appreciate the details of the nodule and repeat on the opposite side. Okay, that is the idea of doing this test. And the Cocker's test, I think for all the undergraduates, whoever is listening this lecture, better don't do it. Please remember, because he has mentioned, I will mention a few points. It is not to be done a bedside because patient may develop a respiratory compromise and you may have problems, which is not acceptable. Second, if at all, if you want to highlight this test, it should be for a bilobar disease. Gland has to be a bilobar disease of longer duration and a larger gland. So it has to fulfill these criteria only for such swellings. If at all you want to describe this test needs to be described. Ultimately, what is that you want to convey by doing this test, Kunj?
So I would want to see for any pressure atrophy causing.
So what is that it conveys? Conveys for tracheomalacia. What are those points I mentioned? Those are the criteria. If it is not there, it is unlikely to have a tracheomalacia. Okay, but it is not advisable test to do. But you should know when it happens. When it happens, you got the point. Okay,
yes.
Where did you palpate for the carotids, and what are those carotids you have palpated?
So I palpated for the carotid. I first went from the midline, and I palpated for the thyroid cartilage, and went laterally, and I palpated the carotid against the C6 tubercle, and for the carotid.
Okay, this is what you people describe. We don't know where the C6 is. There is no surface marking. It's behind. Whenever you take a reference for examination of any structure, it has to be a surface marking entity. That is an anatomy. That is an anatomy where the common carotid is situated over C6 tubercle. It is not a surface marking of the C6. Okay. So it is straightway line drawn from the superior thyroid cartilage over sternocleidomastoid where it touches. Okay. You said mentioned mobility. How did you check for this mobility perpendicular and along the direction of the sternocleidomastoid? What is that you wanted to highlight?
So I wanted to see if the thyroid gland is fixed to the sternocleidomastoid or not.
Anyway, it is wrong at this level. I will not highlight. Don't mention this. That's all for all the listeners, undergraduates. Don't try mentioning the intrinsic mobility of a thyroid nodule. What you can mention is the plane of the swelling. Where is it situated? Which you have not mentioned anywhere in your slides. Okay. Is it deep to the sternocleidomastoid or superficial? Invariably, all the thyroid glands will be deep to sternocleidomastoid anatomically. So that is a test you should be doing. Don't mention about the mobility of a thyroid nodule. Okay. Next slide, straightway you mentioned percussion and auscultation are not relevant or not contributory. That's what you have written. So is it really holds good for all the patients?
So only in case of retrosternal extension of the goiter or retrosternal goiter,
So you should have mentioned percussion in the mediastinal area. There is no dullness. Not that it is extending into the mediastinum. What is that? Why you should check the superior mediastinal dullness in this case?
So to see if there's any retrosternal extension of the neck.
No, you said lower body is felt. Lower body is made out in this case.
Yes.
So clinically it is not. Even otherwise also you need to mention. I insist that you should mention. What is the reason in this case?
To see for any like primary retrosternal mediastinal goiter.
Because you have given the diagnosis of malignancy, possibility of malignancy in this case. So there are every chances that superior mediastinal nodes can be enlarged because it can drain even to the superior mediastinal nodes, level 8. So there is a possibility just to complete your examination. That is the reason for this particular case. If the gland is not extending into the mediastinum. Auscultation.
We have 2 minutes more, sir.
2 minutes. Okay. What is that you want to do now? Kunj, tell me. What is that you want? So your clinical impression is solitary nodule, probably malignancy. What is that you want to do? Fine.
So I would first like to do a thyroid function test to see if the patient is biochemically euthyroid or not. And also I would like to do the tumor markers. Thyroid function test would include TSH. And if the TSH is low, then I would go for free T3 or T4. And for tumor markers, I would like to see the anti-TSH or receptor antibody or anti-TPO if present. And further, I would like to go for an ultrasonography of the neck to see if confirm if the nodule is a single solitary nodule or not. And for seeing for any signs of malignancies on the USG. And if it's if any nodule is suspicious, I would like to go for an ultrasound guided FNSE for grading.
Just mention few points of sonography evidence of malignancy. Malignant nodule. Yeah.
So it is
don't read, just mention.
So the echogenicity, the multinodularity, then the more taller and wider nodules, solid more than cystic, and vascularity, microcalcifications, peripheral echogenicity surrounding the central sonolucent area. Those go in favor of...
Fine, very good. To add to this, lobulation at the periphery and infiltrating margin. Okay, very good. All those points. Okay, you want to have a FNSE of the nodule. What is that you suspect if the FNSE comes as, like, probable possibilities, if it is a malignancy?
So depending on the grading from Bethesda classification of FNSE, I would like to go for the management. So if the malignancy comes as follicular, I would like to go for a hemithyroidectomy. And if the malignancy comes as like papillary carcinoma, then I would go for total thyroidectomy. So.
Okay. Any reasoning for this? Okay. It's all right. For the uses, you have given in the reverse direction. If it is follicular, straight away, there is nothing short of doing a total thyroidectomy. If it is a papillary, even doing hemithyroidectomy, it has got its own indications. We classify the patients into different groups and then take. You mentioned reverse, okay? You mentioned for follicular, hemi, for papillary, mentioned total, okay? So in both the indications, if it is asked what is the indication for doing total thyroidectomy, two reasons you need to mention as an undergraduate. It is intrathyroid lymphatic spread and multicentric origin of the tumors. So becomes an indication. For doing only hemithyroidectomy, there are indications, which I think for undergraduates, we may not insist upon. So you want to do total thyroidectomy for this patient because patient is elderly. What are the complications of total thyroidectomy?
So first of all, the recurrent laryngeal nerve injury could be done because of intra-op thyroidectomy. Then chances of hemorrhage. Then post-operatively, parathyroid gland involvement may cause like a hypocalcemia. And...
Fine, sir. Time is over, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have exceeded. No problem.
Okay, fine.
The questions we can keep for the that you are done well for. Sir, we give these comments. Kishan, next person.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr.
Kunj. Well done, Kunj.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Next, we have
Shiva Rubini.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Shiva Rubini, are you ready?
Yes, sir. I'm ready, sir.
Ms. Shiva Rubini is a fourth-year student from Coimbatore Medical College. All the best, Ms. Shiva Rubini.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, please start the case.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. I'm Shiva Rubini. Today, I'll be presenting a case, Mr. X, a 56-year-old male security guard from Annur, came to the OPD with complaints of pain in the right lower abdomen for the past 1 month and swelling over the right lower abdomen for the past 1 month. The patient was apparently normal 1 month back. Then he experienced lower abdominal pain, which is right-sided, insidious in onset, non-progressive, continuous dull aching type of pain with no periodicity, not associated with food intake, no aggravating factors, relieved only on medication, not radiating to any other sites. Then he noticed a hard swelling over the right lower abdomen for the past 1 month, which was insidious in onset, initially smaller in size, now progressed to the present size. There is a history of altered bowel habits for the past 1 week, which was insidious in onset, progressive type. There is alternate episodes of loose stools and difficulty passing stools. 10 episodes of loose stools per day was present. Each episode involves passage of black tarry stools, which is associated with burning sensation. There is no history of passage of pus or mucus or burns in the stool. history of easy fatigability and tiredness for the past 1 week, history of loss of appetite and loss of weight. The patient lost 5 kgs in 1 month. There is no history of fever, night sweats, cough with expectoration, difficulty in breathing. There is no history of swellings in any other regions. There is no history of difficulty in moving the knee joint. There is no history of trauma. There is no history of burning, micturition, hematuria present. No history of abdominal distension, nausea and vomiting. No history of jaundice, itching. No history of passage of gas in urine. Past history, no history of similar illness in the past, no history of previous surgeries, previous blood transfusions done, no history of chronic drug intake. He's not a known case of tuberculosis, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, asthma, coronary heart disease, or epilepsy. Treatment history, initially after 3 days of complaints, the patient went to a private setup where oral tablets and injections were given to relieve pain. As his complaints didn't improve, he went to a nearby PHC where he was referred to our institution. Personal history, he consumes mixed diet, altered sleep patterns due to pain. There is altered bowel pattern. He consumes alcohol for the past 30 years. He consumes brandy 180 ml per day, thrice a week. Consumes 4 cigarettes per day for the past 35 years. He has stopped smoking and alcohol for the past 1 month. Family history, no history of similar illness or any cancer in the family. No history of tuberculosis in the family. He has no contact with active cases of tuberculosis or COVID-19. After obtaining informed consent from the patient was examined on general examination. The patient was conscious, oriented to time, place, and person. He's moderately built and nourished, afebrile, pallor, not ictric, no generalized lymphadenopathy, no clubbing or cyanosis present, no signs of dehydration. The lips and oral mucosa appeared normal, nicotine stains were present. There are no swellings in the jaw, no hyperpigmentation. Vitals temperature 96.8 degree Fahrenheit, pulse rate 78 per minute. In the right radial artery, heart rate 76 beats per minute, respiratory rate 14 per minute, thoracoabdominal type, blood pressure 120/90, which is measured in the right arm in sitting position, weight 55 kgs, height 173 centimeters, BMI is 18.4, local examination of the abdomen. After obtaining proper consent from the patient was made to lie supine comfortably and exposed from nipple till mid thigh and was examined under adequate light and privacy. On inspection, there was a distension noted over the right iliac region. The umbilicus was in midline and inverted. All quadrants moves equally with respiration. There was a fullness noted in the right iliac fossa. An irregular medium-sized mass, approximately of 7.6 centimeter, was seen. The skin over the swelling is normal. There is no scars, dilated veins, or sinuses present. No visible peristalsis seen. The swelling did not move with respiration. Pulse impulse is absent. Renal angle is free. Hernial orifices are free. External genitalia is normal. No fullness noted in the left supraclavicular region. This is a line diagram depicting the mass in the right iliac fossa region. The other quadrants are normal. The umbilicus is in midline and inverted. On palpation, the patient is instructed to flex the knee and made to lie down comfortably, and inspective findings are confirmed. No warmth and tenderness present. No gauding or rigidity present. An irregular mass of size 8.6 cm over the right iliac fossa was palpable, extending 5 cm from the anterior superior iliac spine, 7 cm from the umbilicus, 12 cm from the right costal margin, 4 cm above the pubic tubercle. The surface is smooth, the consistency is hard, and is uniform all over the mass. The margin is distinct, and the lower border is palpable. It did not move with respiration. It's mobile in all directions. It is non-bilotable. On performing Karnitz test, the mass became less prominent, which is indicating that it's an intra-abdominal mass. It's a non-pulsatile swelling. There is no organomegaly present. Inguinal lymph nodes are all palpable. No other palpable masses in any other quadrants. Left supraclavicular region is normal. Renal angle is free. Hernial orifices are free. External genitalia is normal. Testis is palpable on both sides within the scrotum. On percussion, impaired resonance felt over the mass, and the other quadrants are resonant. There is no free fluid present. Liver span is normal and no organomegaly present. On auscultation, normal bowel sounds heard, no Brui heard. Perirectal examination is not done. Other system examination, cardiovascular system, first and second heart sounds heard, no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard, no added sounds. Central nervous system, no focal neurological deficits. Spine is normal with no visible deformity. Summary, a 56-year-old male who is a chronic smoker and alcoholic with no comorbidities, with no positive family history, came with complaints of right lower abdominal pain and mass of insidious onset with history of melena, altered bowel habits, easy fatigability and tiredness, and non-examination appeared pale, showed fullness in the right iliac fossa with a non-tender, hard, irregular mass of 8.6 cm with palpable lower border and showed impaired resonance and percussion with no free fluid and other signs of complications. My anatomical diagnosis may be right iliac fossa growth, which is probably an intra-abdominal mass. more pertaining to cecal growth. Pathological diagnosis, it may be a malignant growth. My differential diagnosis are ileocecal tuberculosis and appendicular mass. Thank you.
Excellent presentation. Excellent.
Yeah, Rubini, it's
excellent presentation, sir. One of the best I've seen.
Thank you, Kishan.
It's compact and you are not very fast, and you have given like a very clear information by presentation.
Thank you.
Okay. What did you felt at history level? Probably, what is the disease he has?
As its duration is 1 month, and there was a mass and pain, I thought it could
be. So we have heard. We have heard everything. What you felt at history level?
It's more pertaining to some appendicular mass, sir.
Okay, you felt probably it is appendicular disease, and it has turned into a mass, exactly, because it's 1 month duration.
Yes, sir.
What is that you may think in terms of a malignancy at history level? Any symptomatology which you have mentioned?
Black tarry stools was present, sir.
And very good.
EC fatigability and tiredness was there, sir.
Second.
And progressive growth of the swelling within 1 month.
He must have not noticed 1 month how much it has progressed. One more important history you have mentioned.
Continuous dull aching pain.
Anything? Loss of weight. He has lost 5 kg in 1 month.
Yes, sir.
You got the point. Very significant. Appendicitis, it doesn't happen like that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Tarry colored stools, alternate diarrhea and constipation, and loss of weight. So, and what is the age of the patient?
56 years, sir.
56 years. So it has to be malignancy unless otherwise proved at history level itself. See how important it is. Okay. Yes, at history level. So why not ileocecal tuberculosis at history level?
Because there is no history of fever or night sweats present, sir.
Okay. Anything else? So at history level, straight away, you cannot take out ileocecal tuberculosis from the list straight away because he has got alternate diarrhea, constipation, loss of weight, and a right ileocecal mass he has noticed. Okay. How does it present ileocecal tuberculosis versus malignancy?
It will present with the mass, which is a non-tender mass, same as that of cecal carcinoma, sir.
Okay, fine. It's all right. Okay, I would have appreciated if you would have put a clinical photographs again. They are very important when we present the cases. Okay.
Yes,
did he inspection, is the mass felt, is seen on inspection?
On inspection, a vague, ill-defined mass was seen, sir.
Put back your inspector inspection slides because there was some.
Irregular movement.
Okay. So it is a fullness what you have witnessed in the right iliac fossa?
Yes, sir.
Okay. It is not the mass what you have, it is a fullness.
It's a fullness.
Okay, fine. Okay. In palpation, what was obvious mistake you have done is you have mentioned repeatedly about movement with the respiration. Is the upper border of the mass is felt?
Yes, sir, it is felt. Sir.
So if the upper border of the mass is felt, is it relevant to mention about movement with the respiration?
Not mentioned.
It is not. You need not.
What swellings will move with respiration?
Intraparietal swellings, all intraparietal swellings move with respiration, sir.
In other words, what should be there to have a movement with the respiration? Either the mass should be arising from an organ which has got connection with a diaphragm.
Sir.
You got the point.
Yes,
it should have, otherwise, how can it move? So, if the upper border is well made out and you have mentioned resonant node between the costal margin and the upper border, so it is unlikely. Why did you highlight about the palpability of the lower border in this case?
To differentiate it from the pelvic tumor, sir.
Okay. What are the pelvic tumors which can arise in a male?
Not sure, sir.
Yeah, this is what happens. Okay. In a female?
Female tubo ovarian mass.
Okay.
Ovarian cyst.
Okay. And uterine mass. Uterine mass. Okay. Not many lesions arising from the pelvis in males. Okay. If at all, if you talk about rectum and urinary bladder, invariably they will have other symptoms. Okay. You have mentioned in the history that patient doesn't have history of passing air in the urine.
Yes.
What
sir.
Is that called? What is that called? If there is a ear in the urine, what is that called? What should it be called? For a ear, what is the term used?
To rule out vesicocolic fistula, I've asked that, sir.
Okay, vesicocolic fistula.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah, you are audible. It is broken, but it is audible. Fine. Somebody has written nematuria. Okay, nematuria. It is not common with malignant diseases. It is more common with sigmoid diverticulitis, where it can present as nematuria. We will not spend more time. Okay, fine. What now you have come out with a diagnosis of malignancy involving the cecum. One more point you have not mentioned, is the mass mobile or is it fixed?
It's mobile on all directions, sir.
Okay, which I think you have not mentioned that point.
I've mentioned, sir.
Okay. And palatability and examination of the renal angle, is it required in this case?
Yes, sir, because unascended kidney can be a differential diagnosis again, sir.
It is in the right iliac fossa. So to have a palatability and bimanual palpation, the mass has to be in the lumbar region. It has to be in the lumbar. Okay. What was the idea of examining his testicles and highlighting that they are present?
Undescended testes can also be presented as right iliac fossa mass.
Is it just a testis which will present as a mass or something different?
No, sir, I'm not sure about this.
Yeah, developing malignancy in undescended testes. It is not just undescended. That will go for atrophy. If a malignancy is developed in undescended testes, that will present as a iliac fossa mass in a male. Okay. How do you proceed now? How do you proceed?
I'll take USG abdomen, sir, to differentiate it from cecal carcinoma or other differential diagnosis. Then I'll go for colonoscopy, sir.
USG will not diagnose, Rubini. It will not diagnose. It will give the details of the mass. That's all. Okay. Just one logic question, even though you are undergraduate. I say get a USG done and find out from some finding from the radiologist that is the tumor is locally advanced. Locally advanced. What is that finding you will be asking the radiologist? You understood the question?
Yes, sir.
By doing a sonography of the abdomen, what is that finding you will be asking the radiologist to know the locally advanced cecal tumor?
Pericolic abscess.
No. Okay. What I expected was you should look for right-sided hydronephrosis. If the tumor is extending and invariably it involves the lower ureter, and it's an indirect evidence. Indirect evidence in on either side, colonic malignancies or a pelvic malignancies on either side. If the person has got hydronephrosis on the right side, probably tumor, it is locally advanced and involving the lower ureter. That's a very important sonological finding. Other than that, description of the tumor. Sonography will not tell us that it is a cecal growth. It will tell us the details of the, that's all. Okay. So how will you prove? By doing colonoscopy you want to do.
Okay.
Anything else you do colonoscopy? Just do and come out or you do something?
I'll take biopsy along with that.
Very good. Biopsy. Any other idea of doing colonoscopy in colonic tumors?
To look for any synchronous growth or any
other polycystic results. Okay. So other areas of the proximal, distal colon to know for the synchronous lesions. Okay. What will you do? Rubini, what will you do? What is the type of malignancy you expect in this case?
Adenocarcinoma, sir.
Very good. So what will you do? On sonography, there are no deposits in the liver, no peritoneal deposits, there is no hydronephrosis, and biopsy is adenocarcinoma. What will you do?
I'll plan for surgery, sir. I'll ask the patient to stop taking fluids, stop taking food for 48 hours, just fluids. And barium wash can be done. And then right-sided hemicolectomy can be performed. Along with that, iliotransverse anastomosis can be performed, sir.
Okay. You said that you will ask the patient to stop taking everything. What is that you wanted to highlight by mentioning that?
To make sure that fecal...
What is it called medically? What is it called otherwise? Okay, it is a bowel preparation, what you wanted to highlight.
Yes.
You wanted to prepare the bowel, large bowel, so that it is empty during your surgical procedure. surgical procedure. So you know any types of hemicolectomy, right hemicolectomy types, you know? Fine, it's all right. If you know, just mention the names. We'll not go into the details.
I'm not sure. But...
okay. What are the lymph nodes which drain the colon?
Epicolic, paracolic, intermediate nodes. I'm not sure about.
Yeah. See, for what? Epic. No, mnemonic is epic. E-P-I-C. E for epicolic. P for paracolic. I for intermediate. C for central.
Central.
Yes. Central. At the branching of those vessels. Epic. Mnemonic is epic. Okay. Those nodes.
So one more minute.
Yeah. Okay. Do you want to do after surgery? What are the complications of this surgery? Name three complications, important complications.
Perforation, fecal fistula, perforation, stictures.
On table. Anything surgeon can do? Some complications.
Leakage at the site of anastomosis.
That is later, on table, during surgery. Can they injure some important structures?
Yes, sir.
What structures can be likely to be injured? Okay, one is ureter, yes, and second is duodenum. Second part of the duodenum and the ureter. They are the likely structures which can. Later is fistula development. Any further treatment is required for such cases after doing hemicolectomy?
Yes, sir. We'll annually we'll perform colonoscopy to look for any residual tumor presence, sir.
Any adjuvant treatment is advisable after doing surgery? Yes,
sir. Chemotherapy is done, sir. FOLFOX regimen is.
Oh, very good. You know what is FOLFOX?
Yes, sir. Folinic acid with 5-fluorouracil and oxaliplatin is given.
Coimbatore Medical College. So my case is a 57-year-old female. She is a homemaker who came to the GH with the chief complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes for the past 6 months, yellowish discoloration of urine for the past 6 months, and itching all over body for the past 6 months. Presenting illness, patient was apparently normal before 6 months, after which she noticed yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine, which was insidious in onset, gradually progressive in intensity, and it was not associated with waxing or waning of discoloration. For the past 6 months, she also has history of itching all over the body, causing disturbed sleep. There is history of loss of appetite and history of loss of weight too. There is history of passage of clay-colored stools for the past 6 months. There's no history of abdominal pain. There's no history of abdominal distension. No history of passage of black tarry stools. There's no history of nausea and vomiting. There's no history of vomiting of blood. There's no history of fever. No history of trauma. There's no history of chronic cough or breathlessness. There's no history of headache, seizures, or dizziness. Past history. The patient is recently diagnosed as a case of diabetes mellitus 3 months back, for which she is on regular medication now. There's no history of hypertension, tuberculosis, asthma, COPD, cardiovascular diseases, or epilepsy. Though there's no history of similar illness in the past. There's no history of previous surgeries in the past. There's no history of previous blood transfusion. There's no history of any drug intake. Personal history. Patient consumes both vegetarian and non-vegetarian diet. She has no addictive habits. She's having disturbed sleep due to itching. She has normal bladder and bowel habits. Her menstrual and obstetric history. She is a perimenopausal lady and she had regular menstruation previously. Family history, no other member in the family has similar complaints. Summary, a 57-year-old female came with the chief complaints of painless, gradually progressive yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine for the past 6 months, associated with pale colored stools and itching all over the body. There is history of loss of appetite and loss of weight. General examination, after attaining proper consent, and under adequate daylight and privacy, patient was examined. Patient was conscious, oriented, and moderately built, afebrile, icteric, no pallor, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no pitting pedal edema, no generalized lymphadenopathy. There was no signs of liver cell failure seen. vitals. Her blood pressure was 130 by 80 millimeters of mercury. Her pulse rate was 74 beats per minute. Respiratory rate was 15 breaths per minute. And her temperature was 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. Per abdominal examination, under adequate daylight and privacy, exposing the patient from nipple to mid-thigh, patient in supine position, local examination was carried out in the presence of a female attender. On inspection, abdomen was flat with umbilicus in midline, abdomen was not distended and flanks were free. A globular mass was seen in the right hypochondrium and right lumbar region, and the mass moves with respiration. All quadrants of the abdomen move equally with respiration. Scratch marks were seen on the skin over the abdomen. There was no visible pulsation, no visible peristalsis. There was no dilated veins. There was no fullness noted in the left supraclavicular fossa. Palpation, there was no localized warmth or tenderness on palpation. A 7x5 cm globular shaped mass was palpable in the right hypochondrium and right lumbar region, just lateral to the outer border of the right rectus muscle. It is 7 cm lateral to midline and 4 cm medial to the anterior axillary fold. Inferior border is 7 cm from the right costal margin. The mass has smooth surface, regular margins, firm in consistency with side-to-side mobility. There was no other mass palpable in abdomen. Liver span is 12 cm. No palpable lymph node in the left supraclavicular fossa. There was no shifting dullness, no fluid thrill. On percussion, a dull note was percussed over the mass, and on auscultation, normal bowel sounds were heard. Per rectal and per examination, per vaginal examination was not done. Other system examination, cardiovascular system, S1 and S2 was heard with no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds with no added sounds. Central nervous system, no focal neurological deficit. Summary, a 57-year-old female, a recently diagnosed case of diabetes mellitus with history of progressive yellowish discoloration of eyes and urine associated with itching for the past 6 months. There is history of loss of weight and loss of appetite. On examination, a regular, smooth, firm mass, which is probably gallbladder, is palpable in the right hypochondrium and the right lumbar region. My provisional diagnosis, it is a case of obstructive jaundice, probably due to head of pancreas carcinoma. Thank you.
Yeah, Kaushala, it's a nice informative presentation.
Yes, sir.
Can you put the history slides? What is that you felt on history at history level?
So history, because she has yellowish discoloration of urine and eyes for the past 6 months associated with itching. And also she has history of clay colored stools. So I thought of obstructive jaundice, sir. And there was also a history of loss of weight and loss of appetite. So I thought it may be a malignant cause.
Very good. Okay, malignant cause.
Yes.
From the history itself, there is one which I will not mention. You highlighted that. I am really happy. One of the points.
Yes.
If you take that, can you put a still more localized malignant cause for obstruction?
Yes, sir.
At history level.
Yes, sir. She is a recently diagnosed diabetes mellitus case, sir. So most probably the pathology is in the pancreas. And
excellent.
Since she has malignant history also, it can be head of pancreas or perianal.
Excellent. Yes. Excellent. In other words, in a recently diagnosed diabetic patient, if there is a history of obstructive jaundice, it is malignancy of the pancreas unless otherwise poor, 99%.
Yes.
Okay, that you have highlighted. I'm really happy at undergraduate level mentioning this point, which not many people highlight this point. Straight away, it fits into CA head lesion. Straight away, without any other probably. Okay,
yes.
Very
yes.
Good. Okay. So, what is the cause for their itching or pruritus?
Sir, since it's obstructive jaundice, bile salts will be more in the blood and it gets deposited in the dermis at the root of the hair follicles and it will irritate the nerve ending, sir. So, that will cause itching all over the body.
Okay. In the clinical examination, can you put that general
yes.
physical examination slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, in the third row, what you mentioned, third row, what you mentioned, I will ask you to pick up one point. one point out of these points which you have mentioned so that it will help you for the management, which one you will pick up?
So she is afebrile. So
it should help for your management. It should help for your taking some decisions. Because already you know what is a disease.
There's no pitting pedal edema.
Exactly. Pedal edema is a very important clinical examination finding, which will depict us the liver function. Because you know it is a disease of jaundice. So mentioning patient is icteric doesn't have much value here.
Yes.
Okay. If you have been asked to pick up, it's a pedal edema that will depict us, like tell us that how far the liver is impaired in its function.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. If this lady has got fever, what will be your inference?
Sir, if she has fever, then some infective cause, like even cholangitis or
colidocolitis. Cause or the effect? Is it cause or the effect?
Effect, sir.
Effect of what?
Because of infection. Colidocolithiasis can cause fever.
No. You don't bring no colidocolithiasis in this patient, which already you have examined everything. If a lady has fever, what will be your inference?
Maybe she has gone in for sepsis.
Cholangitis. She has developed cholangitis. Okay. So in your clinical examination, how did you say that it is a gallbladder mass?
Sir, first of all, because gallbladder mass is more appreciable on inspection than on palpation, and it is in the region of gallbladder, sir. It is in the right hypochondrium and extending to right lumbar also, since it's distended. And it is a globular mass, sir, which moves with respiration. So I thought it will be gallbladder mass.
Okay. Why in malignancies gallbladder is felt and in benign cause for obstruction GB is not felt? What because is that called? If I am talking about this, what is that called?
Porvoisier's law, sir. Porvoisier's law, if the patient is jaundiced and has a distended gallbladder, then it is not due to gallbladder stones. Because if it is due to stones, it would have caused fibrosis, inflammation and fibrosis of gallbladder, making the gallbladder impalpable. But if it is carcinoma, then it can be, the gallbladder may be palpable, but it's not true for all cases, sir. It's only in 30% cases.
If along with the gallbladder, if a liver is palpable, what are the causes in obstructive jaundice?
It can be because of retrograde bile stasis in the liver, or it can be liver metastasis from the gallbladder getting into the liver, sir.
How do you proceed with this case now?
So first of all, I would like to do basic blood investigations of normal blood count. And then I will proceed with liver function test, look for total bilirubin and direct bilirubin increase in the serum. Then I will look for coagulation profile, sir, PT. I will look for prothrombin time if it is increased. Then I will go on to look for albumin levels to know the liver function. And after that, I will proceed with urine examination and then ultrasound.
After doing a blood investigation, I will ask you to classify this patient into some classification. What is that you will be doing?
Maybe the type of jaundice can be confirmed.
After doing blood investigation on this patient, I will ask you to categorize this patient into some classification which will help for the treatment. So what is that classification you will be doing for this patient after doing blood investigations?
I'm not sure.
If I name that classification, you will tell immediately. I'm asking in the reverse direction.
Sir,
can you grade, can you classify, can you label them into 1, 2, 3, A, B, C, D, X, Y, Z, something like that?
TNM.
Blood investigations.
No, not
TNM.
Or A, B, C, D, Z.
Sorry, if I would have told only A, B, C, D, she would have picked. That's why I have added 1, 2, 3 and X, Y, Z.
Yes, sir.
Not
okay. You have heard of CHIDES classification? CHIDES classification?
CHIDES classification.
You heard of?
Yes, sir.
See how you say yes. If you go in the reverse direction, you will not be able to recollect. Okay, fine. What are the other investigations you want to know?
Then
if I ask you to get a serum creatinine, which is important, how it is important to have serum creatinine levels?
Because these patients can have hepatorenal syndrome, sir.
Fine. So, what is that you want to know from ultrasound?
From ultrasound, the main thing I would like to know is if there is intrahepatic biliary dilatation, biliary duct dilatation, then if there are there is ascites or what is the, I'll maybe know the mass if it's in the head of pancreas, the extent of the mass, if there is any lymph nodes involved.
Okay, any further investigation you would like to have?
Sir, I would like to do CECT because it is very specific for head of pancreas carcinoma.
What is that CECT with this intention that called CECT? What you do for this purpose?
Pancreatic protocol, sir.
Okay. What all things you will come to know other than what is you got from the ultrasound?
The vascularity will be known from CECT because head of pancreas carcinoma is usually hypervascular tumor. Then in the early arterial phase, hypervascularity will be seen, sir, in CECT. And its relation with common bile duct and structures can be well seen in CECT, sir.
What else? What other relations? Any vessels you want to know? Vessels, relation of the tumor?
Superior eccentric artery, portal vein relation can be known with respect to the tumor, sir.
Okay. So what is the treatment you would like to do for this patient?
So based on the investigation, if it's a resectable tumor, then I will do Whipple's procedure. Whipple's procedure consists of a resection of the distal CBD, distal part of stomach, duodenum, with the head of neck, head of pancreas resection, along with the cholecystectomy, sir. And then I will do a bypass.
What are those? Anastomosis will be done after the procedure? Yes,
sir. Pancreaticojejunostomy, gastrojejunostomy, and colidocojejunostomy.
Hepaticojejunostomy.
Hepaticojejunostomy.
After pancreatic, you should mention hepatico. Mm-hmm. Then third is gastrojejunostomy. Any other modifications are available in this?
Yes, sir. We can do pylorus preserving Whipple's procedure.
Which is the important complication of this surgery?
Sir, delayed gastric emptying is seen. And fistula can be formed, sir. Biliary fistula causing biliary leak.
Okay. Important you are not mentioning.
Cholangitis,
pancreaticojejunostomy leaks. That is most important. Okay. Pancreaticojejunostomy leak. Okay.
Yes, sir.
How do these patients, if at all there are problems, how do they land up like these patients?
If we don't do surgery, sir.
Yeah, overall, the mortality is because of what in such patients?
It can cause metastasis, sir. So,
okay.
Liver metastasis, peritoneal metastasis, and even
okay. Last question. What is the other important investigation other than pancreatic protocol CECT? Any other one more investigation which will give?
ERCP.
ERCP is not the, it should not be used as an investigation.
MRCP.
It's a treatment. MRCP also will not. Any other, by means of endoscopy, can you do something and get more information?
Endoscopic ultrasound, sir.
Yeah, EUS examination will give more information, especially with the lymph node disease.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Neha, and I'll be presenting the case now. My patient is a 61-year-old male who is a daily wage laborer hailing from Kiarpuram, Bengaluru, from a lower middle class family, who presented to the OPD with chief complaints of pain in the left leg since... Can you go to the next slide? Pain in the left leg since 7 months and blackish discoloration of the left foot since 3 months. History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently normal 7 months back when he started feeling pain in his left leg, which was insidious in onset and gradually progressive. Initially, the pain was in the foot and has now progressed to involve the calf. Patient has a cramping type of pain. The pain was initially associated with walking, and the patient could walk about 500 meters before the pain developed, which reduced to less than 50 meters over the past 3 months. The pain has now been present at rest for the last 2 weeks. Pain in the foot aggravates on lying down and on elevation of the foot. It is worse at night. It is relieved by hanging his legs at the side of the bed or sitting in a chair with his legs hanging below. History of blackish discoloration of the left great toe 3 months back, which was insidious in an onset, gradually progressive to involve the whole foot till the ankle in the last 3 months. There's no associated itching, swelling, or discharge. He is a known case of type 2 diabetes mellitus since 11 years and is on oral hypoglycemic agents for the same. He is a known case of hypertension on medication since 6 years and is a smoker who has smoked 8 to 9 cigarettes per day for the last 28 years, smoking index of 378. There are no history of similar complaints in the left thigh, right lower limb or gluteal region or upper limbs. There are no history of trauma, no history of chest pain, no history of fainting, transient blackouts or blurring of vision. There's no history of abdominal pain, no history of weakness in the upper limbs, impotence, and no history of pain or redness in the skin or swelling in the skin in the affected limb. Past history, there are no similar complaints in the past, no history of previous surgeries or hospitalizations, and he's not a known case of tuberculosis, asthma, coronary heart disease, and any other chronic diseases. The patient is on tablet metformin 500 mg for diabetes mellitus, tablet telmisartan, and tablet hydrochlorothiazide for hypertension, and there are no history of drug allergies. Family history. There's no history of similar complaints in his parents or in any of his siblings. There's no history of coronary artery disease or stroke in his family. Personal history, the patient consumes a mixed diet. His appetite is good. Sleep is disturbed due to the pain. Bowel and bladder habits are normal and regular. He's a known smoker and consumes alcohol occasionally. To summarize, this is a 63-year-old gentleman who has diabetes for the last 11 years, hypertension for the last 6 years, and is a smoker for the last 28 years. He presented with intermittent claudications on his left foot and calf for the last 7 months, which progressive to pain at rest, revealed only by dangling of the feet of the bed. There is also a history of gangrenous change in his left big toe, which has progressed to the entire foot up to the ankle. So this is the photographs of the patient. Shall I proceed with examination?
Yeah, continue.
Patient is conscious, cooperative, well-oriented. He sits comfortably with his legs hanging below the level of the bed. He's moderately built and nourished. The height was 115 centimeters, weight 75 kgs, and BMI 31.2 kg per meter square. Vitals, the pulse was 84 beats per minute on right radial artery, normal in volume, rhythm, and character. No vessel wall thickening felt. The rest of the pulse examination in detail has been will be discussed later on. Blood pressure was 156/90 millimeters mercury, measured in the right arm in supine position. Respiratory rate was 18 cycles per minute. He's afebrile. Pallor is present. There's no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, generalized lymphadenopathy, or pedal edema, and no external markers of atherosclerosis. On local examination, a patient is explained about the procedure and is examined in supine position under adequate light. Both the lower limbs are completely exposed from the level of anterior superior iliac spine to the tips of the toes. On inspection, the left lower limb has blackish discoloration on the dorsum of the distal half of the left foot, including all the toes. The distal one-third of the plantar aspect of the foot is also involved. Toes appear black, gangrenous, dry, shriveled, and mummified. The line of demarcation is present in the middle of the foot. There is a thinning of skin, loss of hair, subcutaneous fat, and wasting of calf muscles. The nails are brittle and transverse ridges are present. There are no ulcers seen. Burgess postural chest, the ganglion of the foot indicates severe ischemia. The veins and capillary refilling could not be assessed due to the dark complexion of the patient. The thigh of the affected limb appears normal. Right lower limb appears normal and there are no engorged veins. On palpation, the left leg is cold below the knee joint when compared to the right leg. The distal half of the foot, including all the toes, are black, gangrenous, dry, shriveled, and mummified on the dorsum and distal one-third of the plantar aspect. There's loss of sensation. There's hyperesthesia present at the junction of the gangrenous area and the normal tissue. Capillary refilling time and venous refilling time could not be assessed. On palpation of the peripheral vessels, all the peripheral vessels on the right side were felt, but on the left, the dorsalis pedis, anterior tibial, posterior tibial, and the popliteal pulses were not felt, and the other pulses were felt. Movement of joints, left lower limb, interphalangeal, metatarsal pharyngeal, and ankle joint movements were lost. The knee and hip joint movements were normal. On the right lower limb, all movements of joints are elicited and normal. On motor system examination, the tone is normal in both the limbs. Power of the muscle is normal in both limbs. But the bulk of muscle has significantly reduced in the left calf region, but is normal in the thigh as compared to the right. On sensory examination, the left foot has absent crude touch, fine touch, pain, and temperature sensations. However, the left calf sensations are preserved and the right limb sensations are all preserved. Reflexes, lower limb, left lower limb, the patella reflex was normal. Ankle reflex could not be elicited in the left foot. The plantar.
Yeah, Neha, 1 second. Kishan, somebody has kept the timings. Yeah, Pallavi.
Yes, sir. One minute.
Because she is exceeding whatever the time. Yes.
We'll mark it.
Neha, just check it out. Okay, please continue. Yes,
so the reflexes were not appreciated in the ankle. Next slide. On systemic examination, they're all in normal limits and there were no signs of Bruy or congestive cardiac failure. To summarize, on examination, the left leg below the level of the knee showed signs of chronic ischemia with wasting of the left calf muscles, loss of hair, subcutaneous fat, and ganglion of the left foot. Pulse of dorsalis pedis, anterior tibial, and posterior tibial and popliteal artery were not felt. This is associated with loss of sensations in the foot, and examination of the right leg was normal. My provisional diagnosis was peripheral artery disease of the left lower limb, with signs of chronic ischemia and ganglion of the left foot. This may be due to occlusion of the femoropopliteal junction due to atherosclerosis. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, it was a nice but extensive history and examination. I think little areas where you should have cut down to fit into the time allotted. That neurological examination, you would have made it a little short and in maybe one or two sentences. And remaining vascular examination, again, you should have made it a little chart and passing on what is felt, okay? Anyway, it was nice. I want to know at history level, what was your thinking? Because the patient has got claudication.
So this claudication pain that was described by the patient appears more to be an arterial type of pain.
Okay, so you felt it is an arterial disease?
Yes, sir.
Why not a venous disease at a history level?
So the venous disease, the pain won't be intermittent, and the pain would generally be present towards the end of the day, and it would be like a more of a dull aching pain rather than a cramping pain. And it would have improved on walking, whereas in this patient, on walking or on exercise, it was worsening. And
one more important point on history, what will be there in a venous disease?
Yes, sir. In a venous disease, the pain would have would have revealed on raising the foot up, whereas in this patient, the pain increased on
history level. They will have associated limb swelling.
Yes, sir, there would be
limb swelling. Most of the venous diseases, they will have associated limb, swollen limb. But in case of arterial disease, what happens to the limb? It will be shrunken limb. Okay, so that is also one of the important differentiating point. Why not a neurological pain? What he has?
So the neurological pain would be dependent on posture. So the patient would have noticed that while bending backwards or climbing upwards, the pain would have been more, whereas while bending forwards or climbing down, it would have been
deeper. So you felt it is an arterial disease. So yes. You felt, do you think it is a proximal arterial disease or a distal arterial disease at history level?
So at history level, I felt it was a proximal arterial disease since since he had involvement of, he had calf pain also. So it was not restricted to only the toes. It was also present on his leg, the pain.
And you have highlighted in the history that the patient has got rest pain.
Yes.
What is the significance of that?
So it signifies that the disease has progressed now, that even the metabolic demands at rest is not being met by the arterial supply.
Okay. Any other? Yeah, right, right. It says the extension of the disease. Anything else? Why do they have rest pain?
So the rest pain is present because the arterial supply has decreased so much that it's not. Yes, sir. That's the thing I understood.
Okay. Put your clinical examination photograph.
Yes, sir.
So finally, what is that he has in the clinical examination, this patient? Yeah.
So there's gangrene present on the distal half of his foot.
Forefoot. Okay. What is the type of gangrene he has?
It's dry gangrene.
Why do you say it is dry gangrene?
Dry gangrene is generally present with like a shriveled and mummified toes. But then if it was wet, it would have been edematous and there would have been a discharge coming from that.
Okay. Is there any line of demarcation in this case?
Yes, sir. There was a line of demarcation which was visible in the middle of his foot.
How do you know these patients has got atrophied muscles because of ischemia? How do you know? Which I think probably are not mentioned in your slides.
Yes, sir. The atrophy was, there was wasting in his left calf muscles by comparison to his right side.
Did you do that? Any measurements did you do?
Yes, sir, I've measured it. It was 30 centimeters. I've put a table on the slide. It was 30 centimeters on the left and 35 centimeters on the right side.
Fine. So what is your final conclusion? It's an arterial disease involving?
So it appears
proximal.
Yes, sir.
Proximal vessel disease. Okay, fine. How do you proceed?
So I would first like to do some investigations. I would like to do some basic investigations like CBC, then renal function tests. And I would like to check his blood sugar levels and HbA1c to see the sugar control, I mean the diabetes control. And then I would like to do an LFT. And after that, I would like to do an ankle brachial pressure index. Following which, I would like to do a CT angiograph and a digital subtraction angiography. Yes, sir. And then if we are planning
for... What is the importance of having LFT and renal profile in this case?
So since this patient is a diabetic and hypertensive, there's a high chance that he could have concomitant kidney disease, like chronic kidney disease. In that
does
case...
Does those diseases contribute to his ischemia?
It could contribute to ischemia by worsening the hypertension, but we also, I mean, since we're going to give contrast in this patient for the angiography, we have to be careful if there's already a kidney disease underlying.
Okay. What do you expect in that CT angio which you mentioned?
So in the CT angio, we can find out where is the block, what's the extent of the block. We can find out the proximal vessel, the run-in, and then the distal vessel runoff, so that we can see if the if it is possible to do a bypass and if the if it's patent on the, I mean, if it's possible to do a bypass.
I'll give two scenarios in CT angio. One is showing the common femoral block of 2 centimeter size segment with collaterals. The second scenario is the block at the distal popliteal with collaterals of 2 centimeter segment. Which one you will be happy to treat?
So since since they are collateral, it appears to be an...
Both I have given collaterals in both scenarios.
For treating the proximal lesion, I would prefer a bypass. And for treating a distal lesion, I'd prefer an balloon angioplasty.
Agreed. Which one? In other words, I want to know which will have a better results. Is it a proximal vessel disease will have any treatment, whatever the interventions you do, will have a better results. Is it a bigger vessel disease or a smaller vessel disease?
So I'm not sure, but I think...
Okay, fine. It's a bigger vessel disease, easy to treat. You have many options for that.
Yes.
Okay, if it is a small vessel disease, outcomes are very poor. Outcomes are very poor. Okay, fine. Ultimately, what is that you would like to do for this gentleman?
So for this patient, it appears to be a femoropopliteal block. So in that region, I would have preferred an balloon angioplasty, followed which when the blood supply improves, we can look into trying to save as much as the limb as possible. And the whichever is still gangrenous, we have to amputate that.
Excellent. So can you save his gangrenous foot, whichever the forefoot is gangrenous, can you save that part of the foot in this fellow by doing whatever you want to do?
So we may not be able to save it entirely, but we'll try and save as much as possible by revascularizing initially and then giving some time before amputating.
Okay. You have any idea what are the procedures done in a vascular on the vascular system in the limbs? One, you said balloon angioplasty. You have any other, any no names, other procedures?
So bypass grafting, which is an open technique. Where we can use either synthetic material like on autologous or homologous thing like a great saphenous vein, which is reversed. And synthetic materials like Dacron or PTFE are generally preferred.
Any other endoscopic procedures or endovascular procedures you know?
So if there's an emboli, then we can do an endovascular embolectomy.
Okay. For a block? One, you said balloon angioplasty.
So we can do stenting after.
Stenting, definitely stenting. Okay. Yeah, very good. Thank you.
I'm not present here. I'm Dikshita P. I'm here to present a surgical case today. A 65-year-old man, Mr. X, coming from Sulu, who's a retired police officer, came to our GH with chief complaints of a mass in the upper abdominal region for the past 3 months, associated with vomiting, abdominal pain, and discomfort for the past 1 month. History of presenting illness, the patient was apparently normal 3 months back when he noticed the mass in the upper abdominal region while bathing, which was insidious in onset, progressive in nature, associated with pain and discomfort. History of pain, the patient had upper abdominal pain for the past 1 month, which was insidious in onset. It was dilating type of pain. It was felt diffusely throughout the upper abdomen. It was continuous. It was aggravated on eating solid food, but not relieved by antacids. There's history of abdominal discomfort present for the past 1 month. There's no history of water brush sensation. There is history of loss of weight of about 5 kilograms in the past 3 months and loss of appetite. History of generalized weakness and easy fatigability present since 1 month that has affected his daily activities. History of dyspepsia, belching, and nausea present for the past 1 month. There's history of vomiting present for a month, which occurs about half an hour after the patient consumes a meal. That's blood tinged, which is non-projectile, non-bilious, and contains undigested food particles and is bitter in taste. Patient also had complaints of black tarry stools present since 30 days that sticks to the toilet seat and is difficult to flush away. There is history of reduced frequency of bowel movements to once in 3 days. Patient complains of early satiety for the past 6 months. There's no history of difficulty in swallowing or ball rolling movements, bad breath, abdominal distension, breathlessness, or hemoptysis. There's no history of fever, yellowish discoloration of skin and sclera, no history of itching of skin, bone pain, or swelling elsewhere in the body. Past history, patient was diagnosed of peptic ulcer disease 15 years back and has been on regular medication since then. He's not a known case of diabetes mellitus, but a known hypertensive for past 10 years and is on regular medication. There's no history of tuberculosis, asthma, epilepsy, ischemic heart disease. Personal history, patient consumes mixed diet. He was a smoker for 30 years and consumed one packet cigarette per day, discontinued 3 months back. His smoking index is around 300. Patient consumes alcohol for 30 years, about 90 ml brandy per day. He has normal bladder habits, but bowel habits reduced to once in 3 days with history of passing dark tarry and sticky stools. family history, no similar illness in the family, no history of gastrointestinal malignancy in the family. Treatment history, there's history of intake of proton pump inhibitors for the peptic ulcer disease for the past 15 years. No history of any previous hospitalization or abdominal surgeries. Summary, a 65-year-old gentleman, Mr. X, was a smoker and alcoholic with previous history of peptic ulcer disease, presented with epigastric mass for 3 months, associated with pain and abdominal discomfort, melena, hematemesis, generalized weakness with a significant loss of weight and appetite. The probable diagnosis is a malignant mass on the upper abdomen, probably stomach carcinoma. Examination, gentle examination. After obtaining proper consent and ensuring adequate exposure of the regions, examination was done in bright light. The patient is conscious, oriented to time, place, and person. He's thinly built, afebrile, pallor is present, not ectric, no sinuses, no clubbing, there's no bilateral pedal edema, no generalized lymphadenopathy. Patient is COVID negative. There's a single swelling noted in the left supraclavicular region of size about 2x2 cm, which is hemispherical in shape. The skin over swelling is normal. There's no dilated veins, scars, or sinuses. And swelling is not pulsatile. Vitals, pulse rate is 85 beats per minute, with regular in rhythm, normal volume, and character. Respiratory rate, it is 20 breaths per minute. Blood pressure, 150 bar 19 millimeter mercury. Temperature, 37 degrees Celsius. Examination of the abdomen. After getting proper consent and explaining the procedures appropriately, the patient was examined under bright light with exposure from the level of nipple to the mid-thigh in supine position with hip and knee flexed. On inspection, abdomen is flat, flanks are free. Umbilicus is in midline and inverted. A single irregularly shaped mass is situated in the epigastric region, approximately 4x5 cm. Mass moves with respiration. On straining the abdominal muscles, the mass becomes less prominent and it's the rough estimate of where the mass is present. On performing the head rising test, the abdominal mass becomes less prominent. There's no visible peristalsis or pulsation seen. There's no dilated veins or scars or sinuses. Corneal orifices are normal. The axillary area is normal. On palpation of the epigastric mass, mass is not warm, not tender. Inspectory findings are confirmed. It extends from 2 cm below the xiphoid process to 8 cm above the umbilicus vertically, 3 cm from the left costal margin to 2 cm from the right costal margin horizontally, of size approximately about 4x5 cm. The margins are irregular, the mass mobility is restricted, and it's hard in consistency. It's not pulsatile. Able to insinuate finger between the mass and the costal margin, there's no organomegaly or no other masses palpable. Parietal examination not done. The left supraclavicular region swelling is not warm, not tender. It's about 2x2 cm present above the medial 1/3 of the clavicle and extends 2 cm vertically and 2 cm lateral to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. The swelling is not mobile, it's hard in consistency, it's not pulsatile. On percussion, liver dullness is present from the right 5th intermuscle space up to the right costal margin. There's impaired resonance over the mass. Shifting dullness is not seen. Other regions of the abdomen are resonant, indicating no fluid present. Auscultation reveals reduced bowel sounds. Suction splash is not heard. Other system examination, respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard, no added sounds. Cardiovascular system, S1 and S2 heard in all areas, no murmurs. There's no focal neurological deficit. Summary, my patient, a 65-year-old man, Mr. X, a smoker and alcoholic with previous history of peptic ulcer disease, presented with epigastric mass for 3 months, associated with pain and abdominal discomfort, melena, hematemesis for past 1 month, with generalized weakness and significant loss of weight and appetite. On examination, a 4x5 cm hard epigastric mass with irregular borders, moving with respiration and a hard immobile left supraclavicular swelling was present, associated with pallor and cachexia. Provisional diagnosis, a case of epigastric mass causing obstruction and of malignant etiology, probably could be carcinoma stomach involving the distal part of stomach. Thank you.
Yeah, again, nice informative presentation. Only thing, when the restricted time is given to you and you are in the competition with others,
yes,
even if it is a long case, you need to find out where it is important, where it is not important, and condense. Because I saw in your 2-3 slides, there were things were overlapping, highlighting about peptic ulcer disease. The symptoms were repeatedly mentioned.
Okay.
So if you can take out them and make it as a nutshell and highlight what is really important, you will cut down the timings and you will be in a better competition.
Sure.
Otherwise, it was overall a good informative presentation.
Yes.
So at history level, again, like what we ask, what is that you thought of at history level?
Sir, he was an elderly male presenting in the last 3 decades, sir. And he had also significant smoking and alcoholic history.
What is that you thought of at history level?
Yes, I thought of it could be a malignant mass in the upper abdomen, sir.
Upper
involving distal part of the stomach.
Distal, very good. Any, what are the points in favor at history level?
Yes, sir. One is his age. He was a 65-year-old man. And he was a smoker and alcoholic. And he was he had a history of peptic ulcer disease for 15 years. All that contributed, sir. And the symptoms, like he had early satiety, he had abdominal discomfort, vomiting, which was about an hour after taking meals, sir. So all that, I felt it was a
fine. If I say his treatment with peptic ulcer disease for 15 years has resulted in this disease, will you accept this?
Sir, possibly.
Please,
sir.
Please understand the question.
Yes.
If I say the treatment which he has taken for 15 years for peptic ulcer disease, that itself has induced this disease, will you accept this statement? If say yes, how?
Sir, proton pump inhibitors are the treatment, sir. So it will reduce the gastric acid. So decreased acidity is more prone for infection and more prone for intestinal metaplasia, sir. So he could have possibly...
In other words, it's a achlorohydria.
Achlorohydria, yes.
Yeah, PPI induced. It is a supposed theory. Just I'm for information I'm asking and you could answer. I appreciate that. So the PPI-induced hypochlorohydria or achlorohydria is one of the pre-malignant condition. In the sense, they are more prone to develop malignancies. Okay,
yes,
fine. Why do you think it is in the distal stomach?
Sir, obstructive symptoms made me think like that, sir. Because the patient had vomiting, history of vomiting. And he had full early satiety, fullness in the stomach. All that made me think it was involving the distal stomach, sir.
Okay. What is the difference between early satiety and postprandial fullness?
Sir, early satiety is the patient by taking the normal amount of food, taking lower amount of food itself, the patient feels fullness due to decreased receptive relaxation of the stomach. In case of postprandial fullness, after a heavy meal, even after the stomach has been relaxed adequately due to receptive relaxation, filling of the stomach produces postprandial fullness.
Okay, you have a little here and there. Early satiety, the amount of food taken is very minimum. Even yes. For that also, patient feels like having full stomach. Okay, the amount taken is very less. But in postprandial fullness, the amount taken may be normal or more.
Yes, sir.
You got it. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes.
If this patient, say, I ask you to elicit whether he has got history of back pain, which you did not mention probably. Is it relevant in this case?
Yes, sir. For retroperitoneal metastasis.
Metastasis or infiltration?
Infiltration.
Yeah, it is an infiltration of the pancreas by stomach malignancies, which is known entity. If that is there, invariably they are unresectable tumors. More yes. So in your case where he has got a swelling in the neck.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so yes, that sir. History is really important. Penetration yes. Into the pancreas. So pancreas. They lead to unresectable tumors.
Yes.
Okay. In your clinical examination, you have mentioned it's an epigastric mass. Is the upper border of the mass is made out?
Yes, sir. It was made out.
It is made out.
It is made
and out. And you have mentioned that you could pass your hand on either side of the costal margin.
Yes, sir.
So was the mass moving with the respiration?
It moved with respiration, sir. But there was restricted mobility, sir.
No. Don't mix up restricted mobility and movement with the respiration. So, okay, was sir. The mass was moving with the respiration?
Yes, sir. It was moving with respiration.
If you say upper border is made out and you could pass the hand in underneath both the costal margin, how yes, do you sir. Explain movement with the respiration?
So, normally, stomach moves with respiration, sir. Any other mass touching with the diaphragm also can cause movement with respiration.
No. In your case, how do you explain this movement with the respiration? because the upper body is made out, yes, and you are able to pass the hand underneath the costal margins on either side. So what you have mentioned, because it is from the pylorus with other findings, with yes, other history and other findings. Yes. So probably because the stomach moves, because the fundus is in connection with the diaphragm. Yes. Diaphragm. Okay. The mobility of the mass, which you are highlighting, probably if it is there, you highlight. Otherwise, if it is not there, you should not highlight. Okay. What is transpyloric plane?
Sir, the plane passed at the lower bottom of the pylorus.
Where is it anatomically, lady? Where is that anatomically? How do you mark that on the abdominal surface?
Sir, lower part of the ziphy sternum, costal right, both the ends of the costal margin. Lower
what level? What level? What level? Any anatomical landmark where you draw a line and say that it is transpyloric plane?
Sir, yes, there is landmark, sir, but I'm not sure.
You don't know. Rather than not sure, you don't know. Yeah, fine. It's a tip of the ninth costal cartilage, transpyloric plane. What is the importance of that?
About that.
What is the importance? What are the structures you get?
So pylorus, duodenum.
Fine, it's all right. So yes, now finally you think that it is a malignant. Okay.
Sir, I'm not able to hear you also.
Do you think it is early cancer or advanced cancer?
Sir, I think it's an advanced cancer, sir.
Why do you think it is advanced?
Because it has, it has infiltrated the distant lymph node, which is the left supraclavicular lymph node.
Yeah, presence of left supraclavicular lymph node is advanced malignancy pertaining. How do you proceed now?
Sir, firstly, I would do basic routine investigation, sir, like complete blood count, liver function tests. To confirm the diagnosis, I would like to do ultrasound abdomen and endoscopy, upper GI endoscopy. So in the endoscopy, if I'm able to see mass which is less than 2 cm, I can take biopsy of it. If I feel the mass is more than 2 cm, then it is invariably
Why that 2 cm? Don't unnecessarily get involved. Yeah, definitely he will be having an ulcer there. If there is an ulcer, definitely he will take the biopsy, irrespective of the size.
Yes.
Okay, if you are suspecting malignancy on endoscopic finding, biopsy is a must. Otherwise, you cannot prove it.
Yes.
Biopsy is a must. So, you need to have a biopsy done.
Yes.
What is the type of malignancy you expect in this case?
Sir, adenocarcinoma.
Adenocarcinoma. After that, what is the other investigation, important investigation? One, you have seen inside and will you confirm the diagnosis? So, what is the investigation to know the extent of the disease?
Sir, to know the metastasis, I would like to do CT abdomen.
Okay.
And I would also like to do endoscopic ultrasound, sir, to know the layers, what layers it has infiltrated.
Okay. What I expected whenever such questions are asked, one is to confirm the diagnosis. Yes. Second is to know the extent of the disease. Third, to know the metastatic workup of the disease. Has it gone anywhere else? Fourth, to know specific investigations to know whether the patient is fit for surgery or not if your plan is doing surgical treatment. This is how you need to classify the investigations about a particular disease.
Okay, sir.
More so for a malignant disease.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. So okay, you will do CT. What all information with CT, advantage of CT?
Sir,
to know the extent, locoregional extent and the disease. Okay. So yes, if it is resectable, do you think you can cure this person?
Sir, I don't think it can be cured, sir.
Okay. What is the treatment you will do for this man?
I would like to reduce the complications of this person by relieving his obstruction. So I can do feeding jejunostomy. Gastrojejunostomy.
Feeding gastrojejunostomy. You want to say?
Yes.
Okay. It means you want to do just a bypass.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because there is obstruction there, you want to do a bypass.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Any other treatment you would like to give?
Sir, then correct his nutritional status and
No specific treatment, anything you would like to do for the disease after doing gastrojejunostomy?
Sir, since it is in the advanced cancer, no surgery can be done, but I would like to proceed with chemotherapy.
Chemotherapy. If the tumor is resectable, if there is no node in the neck and tumor is resectable, what will be the treatment for him?
Sir, depending on the site of the
same tumor. Same patient, distal tumor. There is no neck node and tumor is resectable.
Distal gastrojejunostomy, sir. Distal gastrectomy, sir.
Distal gastrectomy.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Yeah, Dikshita, well done.
From MMC Mysuru. Today I am presenting a clinical case of a 55-year-old lady, Mrs. ABC, a resident of Mysuru.
Pallavi, your mic is little, like, I think you can fix it up instead of holding that.
Okay, sir. Sir,
and
is
let it
audible?
Little away.
No, sir.
Yeah, please. Is it fine? Continue.
Okay, sir. I am presenting a case of 55-year-old lady, Mrs. ABC, hailing from Mysuru, educated up till second PUC, is a housewife, belongs to upper middle class according to modified Kuppuswamy scale, admitted and examined on the same day, that is 23rd of October 2021. She presented with a complaint of swelling below the right ear since 2 years. History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently all right 2 years back when she noticed a painless swelling on the right side of the face below the ear, which was insidious in onset, initially approximately 1 into 2 centimeters in size, and gradually progressed to the present size of approximately 4 into 6 centimeters. There is no history of sudden increase or decrease in size of swelling, no history of changes in the size of swelling or pain in the swelling while chewing her food, no history of purulent discharge inside of the mouth, no history of cough, evening rise of temperature, no history of pain in the ear, no history of loss of weight or appetite, no history of restricted mouth opening, no history of facial asymmetry, difficulty in closing the eyes, deviation of angle of mouth, difficulty in chewing food, drooling of saliva from the angle of mouth, no history of any other swelling on the opposite side of face or neck. Past history, not a known case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, tuberculosis, asthma or epilepsy, no history of similar complaints in the past, no history of past surgeries. There is no history of similar complaint in the family. Personal history, she consumes mixed diet and has good appetite. Sleep is sound. She has regular bowel and bladder habits. No addictions. She attained menopause 2 years back and is married and has 2 children. She has not taken any treatment for the present condition. And she has no known allergy to any food or drug. Summary of the history. A 55-year-old lady with no known comorbidities came with painless, gradually progressive swelling on the right side of the face below the right ear since 2 years. There are no symptoms suggestive of facial nerve involvement, no other swellings in the neck. My differential diagnosis would be lymphadenopathy, parotid swelling, or a lipoma. Physical examination. Here is a middle-aged lady, well-built and nourished, conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place, and person. She was examined in sitting position in a well-lit room after taking consent. Her height is 165 centimeters and weight is 65 kgs. BMI is 23.8 kg per meter square. There is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, coelomachia, generalized lymphadenopathy or edema. Vitals, pulse was 76 beats per minute, normal rhythm and volume, normal character, no arterial wall thickening, all peripheral pulses were well felt, no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Her BP was 130 by 80 millimeter of mercury in right arm in sitting position. Respiratory rate was 16 cycles per minute, thoracoabdominal type, and temperature was 98 Fahrenheit. A local examination. On inspection, right side, size of the swelling is approximately 4 into 6 centimeter, solitary and globular swelling, situated in the right parotid region, extending superiorly till the level of tragus, inferiorly till the angle of mandible, anteriorly 2 centimeter in front of the right ear lobule, and posteriorly in the retromandibular fossa. Surface appears smooth and well-defined borders. Skin appears stretched and shiny, ear lobule is raised, retromandibular groove is obliterated. The left side was normal and there were no other swellings noted in the neck. Palpation, the right parotid region, there was no local rise of temperature or tenderness, globular swelling, firm in consistency, smooth surface and regular borders. It was non-fluctuant and slip sign was negative. Its size is 4 into 6 centimeters. The plane of the swelling was deep to deep fascia and Curtin sign is positive. Skin over the swelling was pinchable, not fixed to the underlying masseter muscle. And on bidigital palpation, deep lobe of the gland was not palpable and parotid duct palpation was normal. The left parotid was normal and other salivary glands were normal. Oral cavity examination, mouth opening was normal. There was good oral hygiene. Duct opening was normal and there was no discharge. No medial displacement of tonsillar fossa. Lips and gums were normal and palate was normal. Facial nerve examination, sensory taste sensations were normal. On motor examination, facial symmetry is maintained. Forehead wrinkles are present. She was able to raise both the eyebrows, able to close both the eyes, able to blow out both the cheeks. Nasolabial folds were prominent. Angle of mouth is not deviated. There is no drooling of saliva. Platysma was visible on clenching the teeth. No enlarged or palpable cervical lymph nodes. Systemic examination, cardiovascular system, first and second heart sounds were heard. There were no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds were heard and no added sounds. On perabdominal examination, soft and non-tender, no organomegaly. Central nervous system, higher mental functions were normal and no focal neurological deficits. Summary, a 55-year-old lady with the painless, gradually progressive swelling on the right side of the face below the right ear since 2 years, with no symptoms suggestive of facial nerve involvement and no other swellings in the neck. On examination, general survey is essentially normal. On local examination of the neck, the right parotid gland is found to be enlarged, extending above up to the tragal cartilage, below up to the angle of mandible, posteriorly up to the anterior border of mastoid and anteriorly up to anterior border of masseter muscle. Swelling is about 4 to 6 centimeters in size, firm in consistency, not fixed to the skin and underlying muscle or bone. Deep lobe is not enlarged or palpable. No enlarged lymph node in the neck. Facial nerve was normal. Systemic examination was normal. Provisional diagnosis. This could be a case of right parotid swelling, probably pleomorphic adenoma. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay. Pallavi, it was nice presentation. Just 2-3 suggestions.
Yes, sir.
Because again, it's a time constraint and you have been given limited time. So you should have taken out that facial nerve each function and then mentioning. Yeah, put that, okay, but sir. Mentioning, yeah, facial nerve examination was found to be normal. If yes, it is sir. Asked, what are the tests you did for which branch, which muscle, what is its action? If that is asked, then definitely you need to answer that. Otherwise, okay, it looks like a systemic examination. Is it relevant in this case? It is not relevant. So you should have just drawn that, yeah, it did not find any systemic examination finding. And okay, in the summary, again, you have presented the case in the summary. Summary has to be summary only, like in short, two, three sentences. So that you can cut down your timings in your presentation. Okay. So it is a straightforward case history-wise, you thought of any lymph node mass or parotid swelling itself?
Yes, sir. I thought it might be lymphadenopathy or parotid swelling or a lipoma, it could be, sir.
Okay. If you thought of lymph node swelling, what lymph node swelling you thought of? Is it cervical or somewhere else?
Yes, sir. It could be a cervical lymph node or a preauricular parotid region lymph node, sir.
Okay, okay. How do you differentiate between preauricular lymph node swelling and a parotid swelling overall?
The parotid gland lies deeper to the investing layer of the tip cervical fascia, sir. And lymph nodes would be above the fascia. So on opening the mouth, the fascia becomes shortened and therefore this superficial swelling would be prominent and the deeper swelling like parotid swelling would become less prominent, sir.
What are the types of parotid lymph nodes?
Superficial lymph nodes most of the glands are in the parenchyma itself and superficial.
So if that is a case, then the same thing holds good, that opening and finding out remains the same for parotid and the lymph node.
Yes, sir.
Then how will you differentiate? The explanation what you gave to differentiate may not hold good because yes. nodes can be within the parenchyma itself.
Yes, sir.
So how will you differentiate in such a scenario? Okay, lymph nodes are confined to pretragal area. Pretragal
yes, sir, yes, sir.
Confined.
And parotid
will occupy the description the what you
retromandibular exactly.
force. That is an important point than opening the mouth and checking the plane of the swelling. Okay,
yes.
that is more important. And the nodal mass invariably it is a nodular. It's yes, a parotid invariably it is a smooth surface. Top. One yes. is position, second is surface.
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, what is the plane of the swelling which I did not see anyway?
Yes, I have put it, sir. It is deep to the deep cervical fish.
How do you know that it is deep to deep? Can you do clinical examination for deep cervical fascia?
Sir, actually the parotid gland is enclosed by the investing layer of the deep
cervical fascia. Can you do clinical examination for fascia? Can you do clinical examination? You cannot. You cannot do it for the fascia anywhere. Even thyroid you people mention, but it is not so. It can be done only for the muscle tissue where you can make it to contract. So what is the plane of this swelling?
Sir, above the masseter muscle.
Masseter? Okay. If I say the plane, what is the muscle you will doing the test? Because it is extending into the below the angle and it is occupying between that groove. So what is the muscle you get there?
Posterior belly of
the leg. Sternocleidomastoid. Posterior belly is inside. You cannot check clinically. You cannot check clinically.
Yes.
Okay. Sternocleidomastoid. And the tail of the parotid is underneath sternocleidomastoid muscle. So only tail can be checked.
Okay.
Okay, fine. And you have mentioned in the oral cavity examination bidigitally, a deep lobe is not palpable. How did you conclude that? How did you conclude?
Sir, one thing is deep. If the deep lobe is involved, then it will push the soft palate to the and tonsillar fossa and the soft palate to the opposite side.
Medially.
And on examination, one finger, index finger over the tonsillar area, and the other finger, other hand, index finger, we have to keep over the retromandibular fossa and palpate for the deep lobe. Sir.
Okay. What is parotid region?
Sir, parotid region is in the and superiorly till the tragus, anteriorly posterior bilateral mandible or the masseter muscle, inferiorly till the angle of mandible, and posteriorly up to the mastoid or it's the retromandibular fossa.
Okay, how do you proceed now? So you think it is a tumor involving superficial lobe? How do you proceed? Yes, okay.
Sir, first I'll do an ultrasonography, and then USG-guided FNAC will be done, and I have to confirm the diagnosis. That is, I think it is probably a pleomorphic adenoma. Since pleomorphic adenoma is a benign tumor, I'll do a pre-anesthetic workup and proceed with the superficial parotidectomy.
Why do you want to operate on this patient?
Sir, since one is it involves the deep lobe, then there will be a difficulty to swallow and all. And
you can operate on deep lobe also, no? Later, if it involves.
Yes, sir.
Why do you? How do you reason? How do you reason? Give a reason for surgical treatment.
If the patient herself asks for this, this cosmetic.
Okay. Impact. One is cosmetic purpose if the patient is requesting. Fine, accepted. Any other reason as a treating clinician? If it is left like that, anything can happen to this tumor.
Malignant transformation.
So is it a known entity in pleomorphic adenomas?
No, sir. It is essentially a benign tumor.
Agreed. If it is left like that for years together, decades together, can it turn into malignancy?
Yes, sir.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is known entity. Yes, duration sir. Of the benign tumor is a known entity for turning into malignancy.
Turning into malignant tumor.
Yes. If a pleomorphic adenoma turns into malignancy, what is that called?
A mucoepidermoid carcinoma.
No, that is a histological type of cancer. if a pleomorphic adenoma turns into malignancy, what is that called?
I'm not sure, sir.
Okay, carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, duration is an important aspect. Longer the duration, higher the chances of becoming malignant. What are the clinical features of a malignant parotid tumor?
Sir, one, it could turn painful. In initially a painless swelling, it could become painful. And there could be signs of facial nerve involvement. Skin, it can involve the underlying muscle, that is masseter. And it can also involve the skin, fixity to skin and masseter.
Hard consistency and nodularity.
Yes, sir, hard consistency, nodularity. Yes, sir.
What is superficial parotidectomy?
Sir, superficial parotidectomy refers to removal of the superficial lobe of the parotid gland above the fasciovenous plane.
Of? Fasciovenous plane of?
No, patis.
Patis. Fine. How do you identify nerve on the table? Facial nerve trunk? How it is being identified?
Sir, there are a few pointers to identify facial nerve. One is the cartilaginous pointer or Conley's pointer, which is around 1 centimeter below the tragus. The nerve lies beneath this. And the other can be tracing along the medial border of the posterior belly of digastric muscle. Then we can identify the stylomastoid foramen and the exit of the nerve through that. Then tracing backwards from the branches of the facial nerve, especially the zygomatic branch of the facial nerve, we can identify.
Okay. Which is one branch of the facial nerve at most care we should take and at any cost should not be injured?
The zygomatic branch of the facial nerve, sir, because it supplies the orbicularis oculi. And if any injury to this nerve, then it can cause difficulty in closing the eyes and can cause exposure keratitis.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm presenting the case of Mrs. XYZ, 29-year-old female, resident of Daryaganj, Delhi, homemaker by occupation. She presented to OPD on 11 September 2021 with chief complaints of midline neck swelling since 7 years. History of present illness. Patient was apparently well 7 years back when she first noticed a midline neck swelling of 1 into 1 centimeter while bathing. She was pregnant with a second child at the time of noticing the swelling. Swelling had an insidious onset, was gradually progressive, increasing in size from initially 1 into 1 centimeter to around 10 into 7 centimeter over 7 years. There is no recent rapid increase in the size of swelling. Swelling is not associated with pain, difficulty in breathing, swallowing, facial puffiness, and hoarseness. There are no symptoms suggestive of hyper and hypothyroidism. There is no history of weight loss, significant goitrogen intake, chronic drug intake for any psychiatric illness, cardiac disease, asthma, or any cough syrups. There is no history of any other neck or body swelling. Past history, no previous history of hospitalization or any neck surgery. Note a known case of hypertension, diabetes, mellitus, asthma, tuberculosis. Treatment history. Patient took homeopathic treatment for the swelling for 2 years, which didn't relieve the symptoms. There is no history suggestive of thyroid-related drugs intake. Personal history. Patient takes a mixed diet. She has a history of intake of unpackaged salt since her childhood. She has normal bowel and bladder habits, normal sleep cycle, and no history of substance abuse. Family history. There is no family history of thyroid disorder and any other malignancy. Menstrual history, like regular menstrual cycles of frequency 20 to 30 days, each lasting for 3 to 5 days, and average blood loss 1 pad per day. Obstetric history, patient is para 2, life 2. Patient noticed the swelling for the first time during her second pregnancy, and the swelling didn't resolve after the pregnancy. There were no similar complaints in the previous pregnancy. Summary, my patient, 29-year-old lady, has a history of gradually progressive midline neck swelling since 7 years with onset during her second pregnancy and size increasing from initial 1 into 1 centimeter to 10 into 7 centimeter over 7 years with no rapid rise in swelling. Swelling is not associated with pain. Patient has a history of intake of unpackaged salt since her childhood. There is no history suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism and no history suggestive of local pressure effects. Differential diagnosis based on history, it can either be a thyroid swelling, which could be a colloid goiter, a non-toxic adenoma, or thyroglossal cyst, or it could be a non-thyroid swelling that may be enlarged paratracheal lymph nodes. Examination, General physical examination has been done in well-lit room and done after taking due consent. Patient is sitting comfortably on bed. Patient has average built-in BMI of 21.2. Vitals, pulse rate 76 beats per minute in right brachial artery, regular rhythm, good volume, and all peripheral pulses palpable. Blood pressure is 130 by 80 millimeter of mercury in right brachial artery in sitting position. Respiratory rate is 15 per minute, regular in thoracoabdominal. Temperature is 98.5 degrees Fahrenheit. Hair is normal. There's no pallor ictus sinusitis, no signs of Graves of thermopathy, no tongue and hand tremors. Skin is normal on touch. Clubbing is absent, no lymphadenopathy, and no pre-tibial and pedal mixed edema. Thyroid examination, inspection, neck of the patient well exposed and neck slightly extended. Symmetrical midline neck swelling of size approximately 12 cm wide and 7 cm in height. Upper body of the swelling lie approximately 5 cm below the mentum and lower body is not visible. On deglutination, the inferior border is visible. Lateral border of the swelling extending till the posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle with swelling extending 6 cm from the midline on the either sides. Swelling moves at deglutination but doesn't move on protrusion of tongue. On depressing the chin against resistance, the swelling becomes less prominent. No dilated veins over upper chest. Pemberton sign is absent. This is the pictorial view on inspection showing various dimensions of the swelling. On palpation, palpation done with neck of patient flexed and standing behind the patient. Findings of the inspection have been confirmed with palpation. Diffuse thyroid swelling of size 16.5 cm wide and 7 cm height is present with upper border of the swelling lying approximately 5 cm below the mentum and lower border not palpable but palpable on deglutination, but tracheal rings are not palpable. Lateral border of the swelling extending till the posterior border of sternocleidomastoid going deep to the muscle with swelling extending 6 cm from the midline on either sides. Isthmus is 6.5 cm width lying just below the thyroid notch. Swelling has smooth surface, firm consistency, well-defined margins and no fixity to the skin present. No palpable thrill present at upper poles. Carotid pulsation is felt at normal location. Coxa's cyst is negative and there is no local regional lymphadenopathy present. This is a pictorial view of dimension on palpation. Percussion, there is resonant percussion note over manubrium and upper chest. On auscultation, there is no audible buoy present over the swelling and tracheal gush of air was heard in the midline. Systemic examination, no significant finding present. Summary, my patient, 29-year-old lady, has a history of gradual progressive midline neck swelling since 7 years with onset during her second pregnancy and with no rapid rise in swelling, no association with pain, no feature suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism, and no feature suggestive of pressure effects. On examination, diffuse thyroid swelling of size 16.5 cm wide into 7 cm height is present with smooth surface, firm consistency, well-defined margins, and lower border visible only on deglutination. Pemberton sign absent, resonant percussion over manubrium and upper chest. Provisional diagnosis, patient has a diffuse, smooth, firm thyroid swelling, probably of benign origin, with no signs of hyperhypothyroidism, no compressive symptoms, and no lymphadenopathy. Probable diagnosis, simple or colloid goiter. Thank you.
Yeah, Keshav, it was a very fluent presentation, what I could make out. I'm audible, Keshav?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, it was a fluent presentation.
Yes,
at history, you thought of thyroid only, no?
Yes, sir. Probably a benign thyroid swelling.
Okay, you said she had, when she was pregnant, that time she had a neck swelling.
Yes, sir.
And it continues to stay there even now.
Yes, sir.
So what is that thyroid swelling called? Whenever there is something like that, event like a pregnancy and a patient develops, what is that thyroid swelling called?
Sir, if it develops after, just after pregnancy, that it is called a postpartum thyroiditis. But in this case, probably patient had a subclinical hypothyroidism before her pregnancy that got it aggravated during her second pregnancy.
Okay. What is physiological goiter?
Sir, physiological goiter, during pregnancy, it can be present due to increased alpha HCG levels, which can...
I wanted a term called physiological goiter rather than mentioning it as postpartum thyroiditis.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah, in your presentation, straightway you mentioned that examination of a thyroid swelling. Can you put that slide?
So thyroid swelling.
Yeah, you have written it as examination or palpation, something, the thyroid swelling, the thyroid examination, straightway. If you know that it is already thyroid, there is no need to present, no?
Yes, sir.
So it's a neck swelling examination next swelling. You have done.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, you have done the examination of a neck swelling.
Okay, sir.
Okay, not a thyroid swelling. Okay, so neck okay, swelling. Sir. Okay, okay. Any clinical photographs for your patient?
No, sir.
No, okay, okay. What was the idea of mentioning the swelling moves with the protrusion of the tongue for this particular case?
For this particular case, we usually don't require as the swelling is going beyond the thyroid cartilage and till the suprasternum. We usually do it when the swelling is above the level of thyroid cartilage.
Why did you mention for this case?
Sir, I mentioned it for completion only.
It is not required actually. Such a huge swelling. Like you said, it is below the thyroid cartilage level and coming to the suprasternal notch. So you should not be doing. What swellings you will be doing, protrusion of the tongue movement of the swelling?
Sir, if the swelling is in midline and is lying above the level of the thyroid cartilage.
Exactly. Very good. Very good. Okay. It is not required for this particular case. What is the surface of the swelling you have mentioned?
The smooth surface, sir.
Smooth surface. Okay. What was the idea of mentioning lower border in this case?
Sir, in this case, the lower border was not palpable without, neither visible nor palpable without deglutination. But on deglutination, it was palpable. So, sir, it's not a retrosternal extension then.
Okay, fine. What is thyroid paradox?
Sir, in thyroid paradox, the 10 cystic swellings are felt as harder. Whereas the hypercellular solid swellings are felt as soft or firm.
Why they are felt as soft? If it is hard swelling?
Can you please repeat?
Why they are second component of a description which you have described? Why
yes,
they are felt as soft, even though there is a tumor inside? Because of necrosis, tumor necrosis.
Tumor necrosis, okay.
Okay, center part of it will go for necrosis and that may be felt as soft swelling.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. Any other examination you have done other than this swelling?
Sir, other than this, I have done a Pemberton sign and caucus test I've done.
That's what I, what is that? You probably want us to ask what is Pemberton sign and how it is. What is it?
Sir, we ask the patient to raise her arms above, with the arms being above the level of the ears, and then we check for the facial congestion or for the conjunctival edema if the patient is dark skinned.
So just raising or do they do extension of the neck also?
Extension of the neck also, so that thoracic inlet can be compressed more.
Okay. What cases you do this test?
We do it when we suspect superior vena cava obstruction.
When do you suspect in the goiter?
Sir, if there is a retrosternal extension of the goiter.
So is it there in this case?
No, sir. But on inspection,
this test is not required.
Yes, sir.
This test, whenever you have Engar's veins for the chest. Lower border is not made out, large goiter, and a patient says that, while sleeping, he develops a facial edema, then you need to do these tests, otherwise not required.
Okay, sir.
So finally, what is your diagnosis for this particular patient?
Sir, this is a diffuse, smooth swelling, probably of benign origin.
So what is the diagnosis?
Probably diagnosis. Simple goiter.
Simple, diffuse goiter. In the diagnosis, it is better not to mention colloid goiter because colloid is a histological diagnosis.
Histological. Okay,
sir. You need to demonstrate the colloid. So that is not a clinical diagnosis. Okay. It is a diffuse, non-toxic goiter or a diffuse goiter in euthyroid status. How do you proceed?
Sir, first we will do a thyroid function test. We will check the TSH level, T3 and the T4 levels. If they are normal, then we will do ultrasonography. On ultrasonography, we will do the thyroid staging of the swelling. After that, we will do a FNAC.
Why do you want to have a FNAC for this patient?
Sir, if on USG, if it shows any malignant changes, then we will have to do an FNAC.
What is that ultrasound will show us the malignancy in this case, clinically, which is a diffuse goiter?
Sir, if there is a papillary carcinoma with intrathyroidal thyroid lymphatic spread, it can express.
See, it's all right. You should decide doing FNAC after sonography findings.
Yes, sir.
What is clinically felt as a diffuse goiter, on sonology, there may be some nodules on ultrasound. So, there are nodules inside and they are the signs of malignancy on ultrasound, definitely USG guided FNAC of that particular node is advisable. Okay.
Yes,
clinically,
sir.
Patient is euthyroid. And if you do thyroid function tests, if you find the increased TSH of 6 or 7, what will be this condition called?
Secondary hypoparathyroidism. But subclinical.
Subclinical. Okay. Clinically, yes, patient will be normal, but biochemically, there will be altered values, both on either side, hyper or hypo. That is called subclinical. Okay.
A patient came to OPD with chief complaints of irregular torsion, swellings in the right lower limb for 3 years, intermittent dull aching pain in right lower limb for 6 months, and discoloration of right lower limb for 3 months. Dilated torsion swellings on the right lower limb at the ankle region, just below the knee joint, and in the upper thigh region. Insidious in onset.
Vishwa, one second. You have to change the slides. It's not, I think you are using two devices, so there is some delay. Please simultaneously change the slides also. Please make it full screen. It's not full screen. That's why you're not able to change the slides.
Sir, actually, I have made it full screen, but...
No, we are not. We all are telling we are not able to make it.
Yeah, now HOPA is there.
Yes, sir.
So you have to simultaneously put the next slide, okay, on the side.
Yes, sir. Sir, patient presented with dilated torsion swellings on the right lower limb at the ankle region, just below the knee joint, and in the upper thigh region. Insidious in onset, gradually progressed to the current state. There is increased prominence of vein in standing position and decreased on lying down position. It was associated with intermittent episodes of pain for 6 months in lower leg. Insidious in onset, gradually progressive, dull aching in nature. It aggravates after long duration of standing work and relieves after lying down or elevating the limb or doing massage. It is not associated with night cramps and no history of pain during walking. Patient also noticed blackish discoloration of skin over right ankle region for 3 months. Insidious in onset, gradually progress is associated with itching. There was no history of night cramps, no history of swelling of leg, no history of fever, no history of trauma, no history of abdominal pain, distension or chronic constipation, no history of previous surgery for varicose vein, no history of breathlessness, cough, hemoptysis. Patient has been no similar complaints in the past, no history of any chronic medical illness like diabetes, hypertension, asthma, epilepsy, TB, no history of any previous surgery, long-term hospitalization or immobilization, no other ongoing medications, no notice documented history of any drug allergy. Patient has been using compression stocking for the past 3 years. Patient consumes a vegetarian diet, his appetite is normal with adequate sleep, with regular bowel and bladder habits and no addictive history. Family history is not contributory. Summary, a 49-year-old gentleman, teacher by occupation, presented with irregular torsion swellings of vein on his right lower limb for 3 years. He even complains of intermittent episodes of pain, which is dull aching in nature and blackish discoloration around right ankle region associated with itching. From the history, it is suggestive of involvement of vascular system, most probably being varicose vein involving the long saphenous system. On general physical examination done under adequate light with patient consent being taken, patient is comfortable at rest, conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time, place and person, moderately built and moderately nourished. BMI was 30 kg per meter square, no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy or edema. Vitals were all in the normal range. On local examination, exposed both the limbs till umbilical region and patient is examined in standing position. Attitude of the limb is normal. On inspection, attitude of the limb is normal. Localized multiple dilated tortuous non-pulsatile veins on right ankle region, posterior medial region of leg and right medial side of upper thigh. These veins become more prominent in standing position and collapse on elevating the limb. There is blackish brown discoloration in around right ankle region and dorsal aspect of foot. Saphena varix was not present. No dilated veins on abdomen. No ischemic changes in the limb. There is no ulcer on a scar seen. Other limb appears to be normal. On palpation, there was no local rise of temperature over the dilated veins, no tenderness, no cord-like thickening or nodules along the root of vein. I confirmed the inspector findings on palpation. Now, coming to specific test, Brody Tendenberg test 1 and 2 were positive, indicative of saphenofemoral junction and perforator incompetence. Also, multiple tourniquet test was positive, showing incompetence of above knee, below knee and lower leg perforators. On modified Perthes test, the varicosities shrink. Schwarz test was positive. Morrissey's curve impulse, there was expansal curve impulse felt over saphenofemoral junction. On Fagan's test, depression felt it above knee, below knee and lower leg perforator sites. There was no pedal edema noticed. There was no significant finding on percussion, no murmurs heard on auscultation. There was no enlargement of inguinal group of lymph nodes. All arterial pulsations were felt. Other limb appears to be normal. Other system examination, cardiovascular system examination, normal heart rate and rhythm, S1 and S2 heart. On respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds. On abdominal examination, it was soft, non-tender, no mass per abdomen palpated, no organomegaly. In CNS examination, no any focal neurological deficits observed. Provisional diagnosis, a case of varicose vein of right lower limb of primary etiology affecting great saphenous vein with saphenofemoral incompetence, above knee, below knee, and ankle perforator incompetence without any complications as per CEP classification, C4A, EP, ASP, and PR. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Vishwa, it was a fluent presentation.
Yes, sir.
You have mentioned your diagnosis in the diagnosis without any complications. But he has got a history of discoloration of the lower limb, no, around the ankle.
Yes, sir.
So what is that due to?
Sir, this may be due to the chronic venous hypertension, which causes accumulation of blood in the lower region. And there is degradation of RBCs producing hemosiderin, which causes...
Is it not a complication of varicose veins?
Yes, sir, it is complication.
Then how can you put the diagnosis as without any complications? What is that called ultimately? What is that he has developed?
Sir, lipodermatosclerosis.
Lipodermosclerosis. Okay. So this you cannot label this as without any complications.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What is that area around that ankle called?
Sir, Gaiters area.
Gaiters area. Why that area is more commonly involved for this problem?
Sir, this is because, sir, that on that region, the veins are more superficial and there is large number of veins on the ankle region.
And what about the pressure gradient if you calculate from there to proximally up to the groin?
Yes, sir. The pressure is also more at the ankle region.
Highest around the ankle.
Yes, sir.
The venous pressure is highest. Venous pressure is highest at around the ankle. Okay. How did you conclude that this person has got saphenofemoral incompetence?
Sir, on Brody Tendenberg 1 test, there was flow from above downward. So it was confirmatory of means saphenofemoral.
How did you do that test? How did you do?
Sir, first the patient was explained regarding the procedure. And the limb was elevated, patient was made to lie in supine position and limb was elevated. The tourniquet was tied just below the saphenofemoral junction and the thumb was, the tourniquet was tied just below the saphenofemoral junction and the patient was asked to stand up. And when the tourniquet was removed, there was a rapid filling of blood from above downwards.
Within any time difference?
Yes, sir.
Any time entity is required to release the tourniquet and see for the reflux or the vein blood getting filled up from above downwards?
Sir, it was rapid filling from above downwards.
Okay, fine. What is multiple tourniquet test?
Sir, in multiple tourniquet test, we try three tourniquets at the above knee region, below knee region, and the leg region test the perforators. Incompetence.
Okay, what is that? What is the principle of doing this test?
Sir, the location where we are tying the tourniquet, if the perforator is incompetent in that region of that area, there will be filling of the blood, rapid filling of the blood, indicating the valves are incompetent.
How do you proceed now? How do you proceed for this patient?
Sir, I would like to go for a duplex ultrasound scan.
Yeah, tell us what all information you get from that. And
yes, sir. On duplex ultrasound scan, I would in this patient, I would be seeing the saphenofemoral incompetence and the perforator incompetence at the above knee, below knee and lower leg region. And also, I should rule out in case any DVT is on the duplex ultrasound scan. Sir.
Do you expect presence of DVT in this patient?
No, sir. As per the history and examination, I do not expect, sir.
Even otherwise, the patient may not have any history. But in this particular case, after having examined and getting all these signs, do you expect DVT?
No, sir. But still,
Or in what type of varicosity you expect DVT?
Sir, in case of long-term immobilization or previous surgeries?
No, varicose veins. You have examined varicose veins?
Yes, sir.
And you are expecting DVT. What such cases?
Sir, if it is a recurrent varicose vein case.
Okay. Isolated incompetent perforators keep a possibility of DVT. Isolated incompetent perforators, not in saphenofemoral incompetence. Your case is saphenofemoral incompetence.
Yes.
Okay. What do you want to do for this man?
Sir, in this case, I would like to go for Trendelenburg surgery. That is flush ligation of saphenofemoral junction along with stripping of great saphenous vein up to the calf region and perforator ligations.
Why do you want to operate on this man?
Sir, because the patient has been using compression stocking for past 3 years, but he has not seen any improvement. And varicose vein is something that we have to operate ultimately. We do not have any specific other management which can be helpful to patient and to avoid complications in future.
What are the other treatment options for varicose veins?
Sir, we can have that medical management. We can have sclerotherapy.
Any endovascular treatment?
Yes, sir.
Sir,
EVLA, endovascular laser ablation, sir.
Laser ablation. Then?
Sir,
radio frequency ablation. Okay. Fine.
Sir, the PPT is visible.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Karina Lobo, a final year student at FFMC Mangalore. Presenting the case of a 60-year-old postmenopausal woman, an agriculturist by occupation with no comorbidities, presented to the hospital with the chief complaints of a lump in her right breast since the past 6 months. The patient was apparently well 6 months ago. She incidentally noticed a painless lump while dressing. The lump was insidious in onset, initially the size of a pea. The lump did not progress till 1 month back when the patient noticed the increase in size to the present size of a coin. The increasing size of the lump has led the patient to seek a medical opinion. No history of discharge from the nipple, no history of retraction of the nipple, no history of pain in the breast, no history of trauma to breast, no history of reduced appetite or weight loss, back pain, abdominal distension, no history headache or convulsions, no history fever, no history breathlessness. Patient has no complaints in the contralateral breast or in the axilla. There is no known history of carcinoma breast, ovary, or prostate in the first degree relatives. No known history of carcinoma stomach, colon, pancreas, or melanoma in the first degree relative. No history of prior OCP usage or hormone replacement therapy administration. No history of radiation exposure. The patient has had 3 full-term pregnancies and has breastfed each child for 1 year post-delivery. The past history: the patient is a non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, no history of tuberculosis, bronchial asthma, epilepsy, or cardiac disease, no history of exposure to any therapeutic radiation, no history of any drug intake, no history of any prior biopsy done, no history of abortion or hysterectomy. The patient was admitted for safe confinement of her pregnancies. the menstrual and obstetric history. The patient attained menarche at 15 years of age. She has had regular cycles, menstruation after 30 days with 2 to 3 days of bleeding, no history of passage of clots, no history of PCOD, a para 3, living 3. She has had 3 full term pregnancies, breastfed each child for 1 year post delivery, breastfed using both breasts. Her first 2 deliveries were vaginal deliveries and her 3rd was a cesarean section. The age at first pregnancy was 23. There has been no history of abortions or hysterectomy. She attained menopause at 45 years of age. Her personal history, her appetite is normal. She consumes both non-vegetarian and vegetarian food. No disturbance in sleep, normal bowel and bladder movements, no history of alcohol consumption or substance abuse, no history of any drug allergy or no significant travel history. The family history, the patient is the first child of a non-consanguineous marriage. She herself is married and has 3 children, 2 daughters and 1 son. As mentioned earlier, there is no known history of anyone of any BRCA1 and BRCA2 BRCA1 or BRCA2 related cancers in the first degree relatives. The general physical examination, the patient was examined in the sitting posture in adequate daylight with informed consent. She is conscious, cooperative, and well oriented to time, place, and person. She is moderately built and well nourished with a BMI of 24.12 kg per meter square. A pallor was present, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, and pedal edema not present, no generalized lymphadenopathy. The vitals, the pulse when measured in the right radial artery was 81 beats per minute, regular in rhythm, normal in character, good volume, no radiofemoral delay and no vessel wall thickening. Blood pressure was 120 by 80 millimeter Hg when measured in the right arm in the sitting position. The respiratory rate was 20 cycles per minute, thoracoabdominal type. Temperature 98.6 degree Fahrenheit and SpO2 98%. The local examination. The verbal consent was taken. A female attender was present. Privacy was maintained. Procedure explained and patient was exposed up to the umbilicus. The patient was examined in the sitting position with the arms by the side of her body, with the arms raised above her head and with her bending forward from the waist. She was also examined in semi-recumbent position and supine position. Inspection, I have stood in front of the patient and I have understood the following. The bilateral breasts are symmetrical in shape and position. The left breast and left axilla on inspection appear normal. The right breast, the position as mentioned above, both breasts are symmetrical in shape and position. Both breasts lie at the same level. Both breasts are of equal size. In the right breast, there is no dimpling, puckering, no skin changes, no engorged veins, scars, sinuses, powdery orange not present, no ulceration and fungation. Right nipple areola complex. Both nipples are present, symmetrical and are at same level. No retraction present, no cracks, fissures, eczema, no discharge from the nipple. The areola and nipple is brownish in color, no enlargement in size, no cracks, fissures, ulcers, discharge, eczema present. The right arm, the skin appears normal. On raising the arms, no changes are noted and no supraclavicular fullness noted. Palpation, the quadrant method used. The left breast on palpation appears normal. No local rise in temperature in both breasts. No tenderness in both breasts. Solitary lump in the upper inner quadrant of the right breast measuring 4 into 4 centimeters. The lump has a lobulated surface with irregular margins, firm in consistency and adherent to the surrounding breast parenchyma. The lump is not fixed to the overlying skin, no fixity to the pectoralis muscle or the chest wall. Axillary group of lymph nodes and supraclavicular lymph nodes are not palpable. Percussion, the parasternal percussion done, resonant in the intercostal spaces 2, 3, and 4. A systemic examination, CVS, S1, S2 heard, RS, vesicular breath sounds heard, CNS, no focal neurological deficit, per abdomen soft, non-distended, non-tender, no palpable mass, no hepatosplenomegaly, per rectal and per vaginal examinations, no abnormalities detected. The spine appears to be normal. after having taken into consideration the history and my clinical examination of a 60-year-old postmenopausal woman presenting with a lump in her breast that is painless, that is hard, and that is affixed to the breast tissue, I would like to consider the diagnosis of a malignancy of the right breast, T2N0M2 stage 2A. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, it was a fluent presentation.
Sir, I'm sorry, I could not insert any picture as the patient was not consenting for the same. So I have just put a graphical representation of the lump.
Do you do in your institute, even postgraduates do this, like taking official consent and only if they are accepting, then photographs are being put?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay. Did you mention about the mobility of the lump in your presentation?
Yes, sir.
So is it mobile?
No, sir. Breast? No, sir. No, sir. It's attached to the breast tissue.
Okay. It is not mobile on its own.
On its own, it's not mobile. No, sir.
Mobility. Okay. How did you conclude that it is not fixed to the pectoralis major?
Sir, first, I examined her with her arm sitting by the side of her body. I moved the lump along the fibers of the pectoralis major and along and perpendicular to the pectoralis major. They were moving easily, the lump. So I asked her to contract the pectoralis major by placing her hands on her hip and then felt again along the fibers and perpendicular to the fibers. The lump moved, sir, both directions.
Okay. With this clinical examination, I say that it is a fibroadenoma of the breast. How do you disprove?
Okay, sir, firstly, her age, sir, she's above 60. She's postmenopausal. Fibroadenoma, more commonly, it's a benign breast disease, more commonly seen in the age group of 25 to 40 years. She needs to have active hormones to produce the cyclical changes in the fibroadenoma. And there is no pain in the lump as such.
Okay. Basically, she is a postmenopausal lady.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, any breast lump in a postmenopausal patient, malignant, unless otherwise?
Proven. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Alternatively, in this patient, we could also consider a diagnosis of phyllo's tumor since there is no axillary lymph nodes palpable. But I would prefer to stick with malignancy because we need to first rule out that and then move on to the next conditions.
Why did you bring this phyllo's tumor discussion for this patient? In which age group phyllo's tumors are more common?
So again, it's more common in the age group of 40 plus to about 55.
Premenopausal or postmenopausal phyllo's tumors?
So the malignant phyllo's tumor is more common in the postmenopausal.
No, again, you are making it more complicated now.
Okay, so premenopausal, yeah, it's part of ANDI, the aberrations in the normal development and involution.
So does this size and the clinical examination findings fit into phyllo's?
Size. So phyllo's would be larger in size.
No, you only has brought the phyllo's into discussion. I never asked.
Yes, sir. Sorry.
You only brought that tumor into discussion. So does your clinical finding fit into phyllo's tumor?
Not really, sir.
Okay. So there is no need. There is no need for this. Sure. She is a postmenopausal lady. Small lump. You mentioned that it is T2. And there's nothing else, and it is moves at the breast tissue. Okay,
yes,
hard,
sir.
Consistency. So there is no need to get phyllo's into discussion.
Okay.
Unless you have read everything, you know everything about phyllo's, and you want examiner to ask questions on phyllo's.
Okay.
Okay. Why lymph nodes are not involved in phyllo's?
Also, because phyllo's has a hematogenous spread rather than a lymphatic spread.
Oh, even benign phyllo's also will spread hematogenous route.
No, sir. If it's a benign disease, it won't spread. It will continue to grow.
So why it doesn't go to lymph nodes?
So I'm not sure. I just know it spreads hematogeneously.
Agreed. But why it will not go to lymph nodes?
Not sure, sir.
Okay. Why it is known to have a hematogenous spread?
So because there is rich blood supply to the tumor. It is high in...
Like any other tumor will have a blood supply.
It's high in fibrous tissue.
Okay. Okay. What is that malignant phyllo's called if there is a malignancy in phyllo's?
Cystocarcinoma phylloidi.
That is not the term to be used. That is a misnomer. Okay. How do you proceed now?
Sir, after having taken the history and clinical examination, the next thing I would do is investigate the patient to firstly confirm my diagnosis, to understand the extent, to see if there's any metastasis, and to understand if the patient is fit for a surgery or not. Okay. So firstly, the first thing I would do is looking at the patient as a whole, a hemogram is necessary since she has pallor. Then I would move into some mammography and a sonomammography, true cut biopsy, and based on those results, plan the next stage of management and would have a metastatic workup. The metastatic workup would include a CT chest, a CT abdomen, an X-ray chest, a USG abdomen, a bone scan, and ALP levels.
Why bone scan?
Sir, to check for metastasis to the bones.
Oh, is it for this case you want to have a bone scan for a local disease?
Breast cancer is a systemic disease, so with micrometastasis.
Okay. Anyway, for undergraduates, whenever you have a case like this, for all of you, whoever is listening, best way is to limit yourself to the case when things are asked. Maybe, yes, sonomammography, X-ray mammography is accepted. FNAC or true cut biopsy is accepted. CT chest may be accepted. USG abdomen. So that's all. PET scan and bone scan, probably you should keep them aside. Only okay. If the examiner is asking for discussion, then otherwise at UG level, probably you will land up with problems. Okay.
Okay, sir. Sure.
If the patient is symptomatic in the form of bony pains, and you have done a local X-ray and the X-ray has revealed something, then yes, there is an indication for bone scan. Okay. So otherwise, yes, a case like this where disease is limited to the breast. So if you stick to only the nearby metastatic deposits, that is lung and abdomen, that should be enough.
Yes.
Okay. Sir. What do you want to do for the, if you have done a FNAC, yes, true cut reveals that it is a duct carcinoma, infiltrating duct carcinoma, and there are no nodes in the axilla. What will you do?
Sir, there could be two lines of management. One is we could do a MRM, or we could do a breast conservative therapy for this patient.
What is that you will choose?
Sir, given the fact that she's hailing from a rural background and that she's not very close to a tertiary care center, we'd prefer to do an MRM.
Why this criteria should be taken into consideration for breast conserving surgery?
Sir, with breast conservative surgery, she needs to come for regular follow-ups of radiotherapy as well as for regular examination if the tumor can recur. With an MRM, we cut out the rate of recurrence in that breast.
Okay. What is MRM?
MRM is a modified radical mastectomy, wherein we would be removing the structures of the breast tissue, the nipple areolar complex, the skin over the breast, as well as the level 1 and 2 axillary lymph nodes. In the process, we'd be preserving the axillary vein, the thoracodorsal nerve and vessels, as well as the long thoracic nerve. We also try to preserve the medial and the lateral pectoral nerve with the intercostobrachial nerve. The common
your plan is to do breast conserving surgery. What is the surgery you'll be doing?
Sir, the wide local excision.
Then what about the axilla?
Then we would be giving a separate incision for the axillary lymph nodes. Actually, first we would assess it with a sentinel lymph node biopsy since there is no palpable axillary lymph nodes. Only if the axillary lymph nodes are involved, we will go ahead and do an axillary lymph node removal with a separate incision, and this would be followed by a radiotherapy for the patient.
To what? Radiotherapy to what? If you have done an axillary clearance with a sentinel lymph node,
we would be giving the radiotherapy to the chest wall.
Where will you give radiotherapy?
To the chest wall.
Not chest wall, breast.
Okay, to the breast.
Because breast is still existing, no?
Yes, sir. Yes.
You have done only wide local excision.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Okay. Thank you.
I am presenting the case of a 55-year-old postmenopausal lady, P4L4A0, married since 37 years, resident of Loni, which is 1 hour far from GTB hospital, homemaker by profession, uneducated, belonging to lower middle class as per modified BG Prasad scale. She presented to the OPD on 21st of October with the chief complaints of lump in the left breast since 1 year, which has become painful since past 1 week. The patient was apparently when 1 year back, when she first noticed a lump while bathing, which was initially 1 into 1 centimeters in size and gradually progressed to the present size of 7 into 7 centimeters, painless initially, but associated with continuous dull aching pain without any fever or nipple discharge since the past 7 days, which is relieved on taking paracetamol. There's no history of nipple discharge, nipple retraction, or any ulcer or skin change over the lump. There's no history of fullness in the axilla, contralateral breast, or supraclavicular region. There is no history of fever, no history of trauma, if an EC or biopsy from the lump. There is no history of irradiation to the chest wall, no history of HRT intake. There were no symptoms suggestive of metastasis such as anorexia, jaundice, bone pain, headache, abnormal body movements, shortness of breath, or hemoptysis. There was no history of weight loss and no history of any episode of postmenopausal bleed per vaginam. This was patient's first hospital visit concerning the lump. The patient is a non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, and there's no history of TB, asthma, COPD, or blood transfusion. There's no history of breast cancer or any cancer-related deaths in the family. No history of BRCA-related cancers such as ovarian, endometrial, prostate, pancreatic cancers in the first and second degree relatives. There's no history of TB contacts. Patient attained menarche at the age of 13 years and has been having irregular cycles of 30 days duration each. She's P4, L4, A0. The age at first childbirth was 19 years and her total years of breastfeeding amount to 8 years, both breasts included. Patient underwent a mini laparotomy for bilateral tubal ligation 2 years after her last delivery with an uneventful post-op and intra-op period. She attained menopause at the age of 53 years and there hasn't been any history of pain, itching or discharge per vaginum in the postmenopausal period. Patient is a vegetarian by diet, non-smoker, non-alcoholic with normal sleep, bowel, bladder habits. To summarize, this is the case of a postmenopausal lady who presented with the complaints of lump in the left breast since past 1 year, initially 1 into 1 centimeter painless, gradually progressing to the present size of 7 into 7 centimeters, with the onset of dull aching pain since 1 week without any complaints of nipple discharge, retraction, skin changes or fullness in the axilla or contralateral breast. On examination, first of all, the patient was examined in a well-lit room after taking an informed consent. Patient was conscious, well-oriented to time, place, person, and was sitting comfortably on bed and was vitally stable. Her Karnofsky performance scale was 90. She had a lean build with a BMI of 22.2. There was no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy, or edema. She was well hydrated and systemic examination was within normal limits. Abdomen was soft, non-tender, non-distended with a 1 cm infra-umbilical scar healed by primary intention. Liver was palpable 1 cm below the costal margin, non-tender, moving with respiration, smooth surface and sharp edges. For loco-regional examination, patient was exposed from neck till waist in a well-lit room in the presence of a female chaperone, which was a daughter-in-law in this case. Consent was taken for marking the diseased area as well as for taking pictures for this presentation. The patient was inspected in 4 positions. Firstly, sitting with hands on the side. So a 7 cm into 4 cm lump was visible in the upper half of the left breast, 6 cm from the midline, 10 cm below the midpoint of clavicle with uneven surface, irregular borders, and no overlying skin changes or engorged veins. The left breast also appeared slightly higher than the right, with the left nipple being displaced towards the lump. The left nipple was 23.8 cm below the midpoint of clavicle, as against the right nipple, which was 26 cm below. The nipples were otherwise central in position, not retracted, equidistant from midline at 12.6 cm. There was no discharge, cracks, fissures on the nipple areola complex, no dimpling, puckering, satellite nodules, podorange, or any kind of fullness in the axilla, supraclavicular region, or neck. The right breast appeared normal and the bilateral upper limbs were normal. Patient was examined with arms raised above the head and hands on the hip pressing downwards. There was no evidence of dimpling. Also, on leaning forward, the left breast didn't fall forward as much as the right one. Palpation was done in supine position with arms raised above the head using the dial clock method. The right breast was palpated first. It revealed normal skin temperature, no superficial tenderness, no palpable lump or tenderness in any quadrant. This was followed by the palpation of left breast. The skin temperature was normal without any superficial tenderness. A 10.3 into 10.5 centimeters, well-defined, firm to hard lump, irregular in shape, with uneven surface, was palpated in the upper inner and outer quadrant, extending to beneath the nipple areola complex, almost 1.5 centimeters from the nipple. The lump was fixed to the underlying breast tissue, but not fixed to skin, pectoralis major or serratus anterior. Axillary, cervical and supraclavicular lymph nodes were not palpable. On examination of the back, there was no spine tenderness or any clinically apparent deformity. PV examination was within normal limits without any adnexal mass. PR examination was also within normal limits with normal fecal staining. Thus, to summarize, on examination, there was a hard, well-defined non-tender lump in the upper inner and outer quadrants of left breast, size approximately 10.2 centimeters into 10.5 centimeters, extending up to the nipple areola complex, 1 centimeter from the nipple, with irregular margins, uneven surface, fixed to the underlying breast tissue, without any fixity to the skin or chest wall, or palpable nodes in the axilla. Sir, my provisional diagnosis for this case would be left-sided carcinoma breast, clinically T3N0N0, stage 2B.
Yeah, Mimansa, it was a nice presentation. But I wanted to clarify, I did not understand your systemic examination in the beginning and then followed by local regional examination. This is what is practiced in your institute?
No, sir. First, the sequence is general physical examination, followed by local regional examination, followed by systemic examination.
But you mentioned here per abdomen and other examination first and then followed by breast examination.
Sir, I'm sorry for this mistake.
You need not be sorry. I wanted to know, is it the way, like, it is not a blender, but just to have information. Is it being taught like that or practiced like that in your institute or?
No, sir. The ideal format is general physical examination, followed by local regional, followed by systemic. That's what we do.
Like what we follow, you are also following the same way, no?
Yes.
Not different.
Some people will have the head to foot examination first, followed by the diseased part, local examination, sir. So I've seen one or two teachers teaching, sir. That's why I was asking.
Okay, sir.
You've been taught like that.
Okay. So what is the diagnosis you have made?
Sir, I'm suspecting a malignancy of the left breast, clinically T3N0M0, which will be stage 2.
You tell us the points in favor from the history and examination to favor that it is malignancy or a malignant lump.
So the lump is progressively increasing in size.
History and examination.
Okay, sir.
I said points in favor from history and examination. Yeah.
Sir, it's the lump was initially painless. It was hard, fixed to the breast tissue. And
history, you don't want to take points from the history. She's a postmenopausal patient.
Yes, sir.
She's a postmenopausal patient. What is the duration of the history?
Sir, it's a long-lasting history. She has the complaints since 1 year, past 1 year.
Okay, 1 year history, postmenopausal patient. She belongs to risk category, risk group of patients.
No, sir, she doesn't. She doesn't have any family history.
Fine. Examination findings.
So the lump was well defined, but it had irregular margins. It was firm to hard in consistency. And sir, it was fixed to the underlying breast tissue.
Okay. Axilla, anything in the axilla?
No, sir, axilla was clear bilaterally.
Fine. How do you proceed now?
Sir, I would like to proceed. First of all, I would like to confirm my diagnosis using triple assessment, which includes clinical assessment that I've already done, followed by radiological assessment, which will be mammography in this case, since the patient is older than 35 years, followed by a trochoid biopsy, preferably.
Yeah, continue.
Yes, sir. Sir, apart from that, I would also like to do some routine baseline investigations since I want to plan this patient for OT.
Since the lump is clinically palpable and as well you can do FNAC and confirm, why do you want X-ray mammography for this patient? What is the idea of doing that?
Sir, X-ray mammography, particularly the medial lateral oblique view, will give me an idea about the invasion of pectoralis major, though I've appreciated that clinically also, but a better idea as to the obliteration of retromammary space. And also, sir, I can visualize axilla in that view. So,
any other reason you can substantiate getting X-ray mammography?
Sir, to confirm whether my lump is malignant or not, I can see my microcalcifications.
It will not confirm. It will give some indirect evidence. X-ray mammography is not for confirmation of malignancy.
Right, sir.
Any other reason? Okay, what is the difference between multicentricity and multifocality?
So multifocality is when two tumors are present within a gap of 4 centimeters, and multicentricity is when they're present at a gap of more than 4 centimeters. So since I'm looking forward to, since I can do a breast conservation surgery also for this patient, that will depend. But to rule out multicentricity, yes, a mammography will be helpful.
Is it required now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that is the reason why you need to have a X-ray mammography. Okay. Fine. Uh-huh. Anything you would like to do investigation for the axilla for this particular patient?
Yes, sir. Sir, I would like to do an ultrasound as an extension of my clinical examination of bilateral axilla to look for any suspicious nodes, which can be appreciated by the hilum being more prominent. They'll be rounder and there can be some perinodal invasion also.
If they are there, what will you do?
Sir, I'll still proceed with the sentinel lymph node biopsy. And
no, you don't want to do FNAC at that time? USG yes, sir. FNAC yes, sir. And confirm?
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Okay, fine. So what do you want to do for this patient now?
Sir, I can offer her two options, either a breast conservation surgery, though the lump is large. We need to calculate the lump to breast tissue ratio for this patient and also rule out any other contraindications of breast conservation surgery. Sir, if she's fit, we'll take her up for that. And if she's not, then we'll proceed with MRM.
What is that you wanted to rule out contraindications for doing breast conserving surgery?
Sir, breast conservation surgery includes radiotherapy also. So there are certain contraindications of radiotherapy which I would like to rule out. Also, sir, multicentricity is
what,
a contraindication.
What is that you tell, no? What is the contraindication you want to rule out? Mention, what are those?
Sure, sir. So there should be no past history of irradiation to the chest wall. So the patient is postmenopausal, so definitely pregnancy has been ruled out. And sir, any evidence of collagen diseases?
Okay, fine. So what is now finally you have decided to do for this lady?
Sir, I can offer a BCS or MRM.
Okay, fine. What is done in BCS?
Sir, we'll remove the lump along with a cuff of healthy tissue, preferably a 1 centimeter margin, in a cosmetically accepted manner, followed by radiotherapy.
To the axilla? You have to address the axilla also, no?
Yes, sir.
What is that you will be doing to the axilla?
So first of all, I'll do a sentinel lymph node biopsy. So if there are nodes which are positive, then I'll do an axillary dissection also.
Okay. How many minimum nodes to be removed if your plan is to do sentinel lymph node biopsy?
Sir, I'm not sure, but 10.
That is for axillary dissection.
Okay.
For a sentinel lymph node biopsy, ideally.
Sir, I'm not
minimum aware. Four nodes needs to be removed, ideally. Then only you can comment that yes, sentinel node is negative or positive. The 10 is for axillary dissection.
Okay, sir.
Okay, ideal axillary dissection. If you have removed axillary dissection about 15 nodes and 3 are positive, what is that called out of 15, 3 are positive?
Sir, I don't know.
Okay, fine. That is called lymph node ratio. That is more important than number of nodes dissected. Higher the lymph node ratio, poorer the prognosis, aggressive the tumor, and needs to be treated aggressively. That is more important than the number of nodes dissected. You want to send the specimen for any IHC markers?
Yes, sir. Sir, okay. After taking a trochoid biopsy, I would like to assess the ERPR positivity as well as the HER2-neo positivity in this case. So if she comes out to be positive for ERPR, I'll try to administer hormonal therapy, which will be in the form of aromatase inhibitors since she's postmenopausal.
What are the chances of this ERPR being positive for this patient?
Sir, I'm not aware of the percentage.
For this patient means what is that I am highlighting?
Sir, postmenopausal lady.
Postmenopausal. So if the patient is postmenopausal, what are the chances of ERPR being positive? Higher chances or lower chances?
Sir, lower chances.
Okay. You should have prepared as an intern. More than 60% of the chances, higher chances. Okay. Postmenopausal patients are more ERPR positive. ERPR positivity is a less aggressive tumor or a more aggressive tumor?
Sir, it's a lesser aggressive
tumor. Less aggressive. That is why postmenopausal patients do better compared to premenopausal patients. is the breast cancer is classified after IHC markers in some ways? Is it being classified?
Yes, sir.
How?
So they are classified into luminal type AB, HER2 enriched, and also as triple negative.
Okay, very good. Okay.
So, sir, luminal A is ERPR positive with HER2 new negative with a Ki-67 index of less than 15%, while luminal B is ERPR positive. It can be HER2 new positive as well, which is triple positive with a Ki-67 index of more than 15%. HER2 new enriched will be ERPR negative and HER2 new positive, again with a Ki-67 of more than 15%, and triple negative will be all three negative with a higher Ki-67 index.
Which carries worse prognosis among four?
Sir, triple negative carries a worse prognosis, but paradoxically, it's very sensitive to chemotherapy.
What are the drugs used for chemotherapy in CA breast?
So there are multiple regimens. We have CAF regimen, CMF regimen. CAF includes cyclophosphamide, adriamycin, and 5-fluorouracil. CMF will be cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, and 5-fluorouracil. So if the carcinoma is resistant to adriamycin, then we proceed with a Taxol-based therapy. And if it's still resistant, then we proceed with exabepilone.
If patient is triple negative, anything else is done other than giving chemotherapy?
So they are very sensitive to chemotherapy, usually, triple negative.
Other than triple drugs, chemotherapy, anything else? Because triple negative is a little different way of managing.
So we can give radiotherapy?
No. Okay, it's all right. DJ.